It's time to find out who can adapt best to two new challenges. Hi, everybody. Welcome to day four of individual competition at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. We're inside the soccer stadium at the StubHub Center in Carson, California. I'm Sean Woodland alongside 2009 CrossFit Games champion Tanya Wagner, and Nikki Brazier is on the competition field. And for the first time, these athletes are facing the snail, and the rope climb is a little bit different here, too.
Well, these athletes are going to have three rounds to get through a 500-meter berm run, and then they're going to push a 40-foot snail. And every time they cross under Zeus, the big rig in the center of the field, they're going to have to perform two rope climbs. So once they go toward the snail, they're going to have to do two rope climbs, and then on the way back on the next run, they're going to have to perform two rope climbs. The snail, that little puppy right there, that weighs 100 pounds, 160 pounds empty, but 400 pounds for the women to push that snail.
They filled it with sand, so it does present a unique challenge. I'll have more on that in a second. There are 20 women in this heat, and in lane number 10 is a woman who can move her way up a rope pretty quickly, and that's China Cho.
China Cho's best finish so far came at the swim event on Thursday. She took a fifth in that event, and this could be her second highest event finish. She always does well when it comes to rope climbs, and she also adapts really well to any new objects.
In lane three, the woman who set the event record in the final regional event that featured legless rope climbs, Alethea Boone.
Alethea Boone held that record until the very final weekend, and she's very, again, another athlete that can adapt well on the fly, that will do well in this event. And Christy Adkins, her seventh games appearance, she had her best two finishes came her first two events in Aromas on Wednesday.
The event is Climbing Snail. It's event number 8 of the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. And it starts with that 500-meter run up and over the berm.
I expect this portion to be really where they're going to sprint the fastest, because they don't want that log jam in the stairs. After that, they're going to probably settle. Wisest thing to do, because you're not going to win it here sprinting this first portion and then getting back if you're wrecked on the rope.
Up the stairs, and then they'll make a left turn over the berm here at the soccer stadium at the StubHub Center in Carson, California. There is a 21-minute time cap on this event. We mentioned the snail. We also talked about the rope. The difference between these rope climbs and rope climbs that we've seen in the past is that they're going to be a combination of legless and with their legs.
The rope is actually short. Typically, we see the rope hang all the way down to the ground, but because the rope is short, when the athletes jump up, their legs are just free dangling. So it's going to be a crossbreed between the legless rope climb until their legs actually, they get pulled high enough and their legs can be used. Some athletes, I expect, though, not to even bother with that. They did not have a chance to practice with the rope, so they may just choose to go up legless right from the start, not even bother with their legs, maybe just hold on if their grip comes into factor.
Camila Blanc-Bazinet is on the left. She is your leader. Behind her, the youngest woman in the field. That's 19-year-old Maddie Sturt making her way down the stairs. And then Turi Helgadottir, number 57, is right behind them.
Now, based on where their lane is, they have a slight advantage going out. So we'll be able to really tell who's in the lead once they get back to their first rope climb. But as of right now, Camila Blanc-Bazinet has some work to do. She's coming into today in 24th place, definitely not where she wants to be. So, you know, all these ladies here in the second half of the leaderboard, they want to make a push. They don't know how many events necessarily are left, but every event matters. Every point that they can get matters. Camila's strong on these rope climbs.
Camila Blanc-Bazinet on the right, Turi Helgadottir is on the left. They will be the first two women to these rope climbs, and there's the gap between the floor and the rope. So you have to start out legless. You can use your legs once you move up that rope. Helgadottir wraps her legs and secures them, moves up, and they can touch any part of the Zeus rig. They have to keep their hands on the rope below that black line, then they can jump right off and onto the crash pad. Rope climbs here, then onto the snail.
Watch these athletes. They don't have any problem climbing ropes typically, but you can see just how awkward it is. There's no pull from the rope to kind of stabilize it and hold down and have enough weight to really steady it. So Camille, on her first one, she used her legs. There she had to start with the legless, but it's almost a little bit more awkward than typical. And oh, look who
this
it
is. Christy Adkins. First time we ever saw legless rope climbs in competition was at the 2013 Reebok CrossFit Games. Christy Adkins finished that event. She finished second in her heat, but it did put her on top of the overall leaderboard after Friday night that year. Now a 40-foot snail push, and what makes this unique is that there is sand in the bottom of that cylinder, so you cannot get any momentum rolling this thing. The sand always sinks to the bottom. They have to roll it past that black line, then it's two more rope climbs.
The key to this snail is really to stay low, push from that underside, really get what you can with your legs to drive, but these girls' legs are beat up, so they're going to really have to stay tight. And you can see how that weight just pushed Chrissy Adkins back.
And these women have not had a chance to practice with this thing. This is the first time they've gotten their hands on it, so you're going to see a lot of different techniques as they try to figure out the best way to move this. Turi Helgadottir got it done the quickest, and she's already back on her final two rope climbs to close out round number one. Helgadottir's on the right. Camila Blanc-Bazinet is in second. She'll return for two more rope climbs and then another 500-meter run up and over the berm.
I know there's a 21-minute time cap. However, I'm going to say this is going to sound weird, but it's too short of an event with only three rounds to really let these ladies adapt and know how it's going to feel or give them enough time to really know what they should do or what they should have done. By the time the second round comes into play, this thing's almost over. So if some of these ladies are sandbagging or going a little too slow or they're being cautious on that snail, it's going to take too much time for them to figure it out.
Turi Helgadottir is off of her second two rope climbs ahead of Camila Blanc-Bazinet. Carlene Matthews is now challenging Camila Blanc-Bazinet for second place, as are China Cho and Alethea Boone. But right now, Turi Helgadottir all by herself as she begins round number two.
Turi Helgadottir, this is her third games.
Camila Blanc-Bazinet, who's in third, has slowed on these ropes, and that's exactly what you were talking about. The bottom of that rope is a problem.
And she almost looked at it like, what just happened there? They're used to the climbing. They know what it feels like. So it's very awkward when you go to grab for something and then you don't have the extra push. You have to use a lot more of your core to really straighten your legs out to stand up rather than push against the weight of the rope.
Turi Helgadottir is in the lead. She is getting set to move to the top of that berm. Meanwhile, Candace Wagner, China Cho, and Carlene Matthews are all on the run. And now Alethea Boone, Christy Atkins, Sheila Barden, Emily Bridgers are all on the run as well, and they're chasing that woman, Turi Helgadottir, who comes in 22nd place overall. Whitney Cappellucci is behind Turi Helgadottir. The top of your screen is now correct as Helgadottir is getting set to finish a run. A run counts as just one rep on the scoring hat at the top of your screen. The leader's name will be highlighted in a blue box. That's Carlene Matthews, who currently sits in second place, and she is not even to the top of the berm here at the soccer stadium. China Cho is right behind her, followed by Candace Wagner.
And Turi Helgadottir has just been so strong on not only the run portion, but really on each adaptation of figuring out the rope and then that snail. A lot of these ladies, what you feel after pushing that 400-pound snail, it really builds up. It's something that the spectators, the fans, you don't always see that, but when they get back to the rope and they get back on the run, you're just trying to catch your breath.
Turi Helgadottir back to the rope, two rope climbs here, and then another 40-foot snail push, and right now it is Turi Helgadottir just running away with the first heat of event number eight, climbing snail.
Usually we see the last place finisher is by themselves in the stands, you know, and in this case we see the first place all by themselves.
These are the women chasing Turi Helgadottir. Carlene Matthews is out front, and she'll make the turn in her lane back to the rope. And Turi Helgadottir trying to find a way to wrap her feet and get herself up that rope. She's passing that black line. They have to keep their hands on the rope on the way down below that black line. Then they can let go and just jump right off.
And this rope climb is it's right around the 15-foot mark. So typical for what they're used to seeing in competition. She adapts well, and watch the way she attacks this snail. You know, you have to keep it in your lane. She's really efficient, gets that nice big hit right from the low point, keeps her body nice and low, really drives with her legs. She doesn't look up, she keeps her head down, which allows her core to stay a lot tighter.
And Turi Helgadottir basically got a running start of this thing and put her shoulder into it to just give it a little bit of a budge. And now just methodically working it down the field on her second 40-foot push. After this, back to Zeus, two more rope climbs, and then another berm run. But Turi Helgadottir figured this thing out extremely quickly, and she is your heat leader by a long shot.
She didn't only move that thing and keep that momentum going, but she kept it in a straight line. Not having to adjust and re-angle it, get it in your lane, is huge. That was so quick.
They have narrowed the playing field here at the soccer stadium. Athletes do not have a lot of room for error on those things, so keeping it within your lane is important. As Tanya said, you don't want to waste time trying to readjust that thing and getting it back on its path. China Cho is the second woman to the snail. She's in the yellow on the right of the screen. She just left the frame. It's Carlene Matthews. China Cho really strong in the water. She is a swimmer for the San Jose State Spartans.
Despite all of her competition experience, did tell me earlier that she was nervous for the snail, considering the fact that she never had a chance to practice ahead of time. But she said not as nervous as she could have been, because she was glad that all the athletes at least were on the exact same page, never having been able to try it before.
Thanks, Nikki. China Cho is back to the rope. Turi Helgadottir on the right of your screen in the purple shorts is your leader. That's Carlene Fuhrer, who is just finishing her second 500 meter run.
Turi has about a 47 second lead on China Cho, which is huge in this type of event, and that's going to be what the other ladies in the next heat are going to be looking for. They're going to have a time to shoot for, but they're going to have to work hard to make that look as easy as she's making it look.
You saw Camila Blanc-Bazinet working her way back to that snail as Turi Helgadottir returns for her third and final run up and over the berm here at the soccer stadium. China Cho trying to chase her down. Cho has done her final two rope climbs of this round, and now on to round three for her. Turi Helgadottir making her way up the steps. China Cho trying to track her down. Helgadottir has never won an event at the CrossFit Games. Her best finish was a second place result in Sprint Course 1. That was last year, but she has finished in the top 10 four times in 24 events in which she's competed during her career.
Shaking out those arms. You know, there's a lot of forearms yesterday, a lot of grip with all those cleans that they did, all the pull-ups that they did. And usually it's not the day that you do the movements, it's the next day where you really feel the fatigue.
Turi Helgadottir about ready to crest the berm and work her way down back into the soccer stadium. Two rope climbs and then one final snail push, 40 feet, and then she'll close out her event. China Cho still remains in second place. Carlene Matthews is behind her, and then the seven-time Games veteran Christy Adkins sits in fourth. Adkins is now starting her run, as is Sheila Barden. Helgadottir making her way down the steps. China Cho on the decline of that berm. Two final rope climbs for Helgadottir, and then one final snail push. Again, that snail weighs 400 pounds in there. It's filled with sand, so it's not one solid object in there. That sand always settling at the bottom, making that device more difficult to push. Helgadottir making her way back to Zeus, that gigantic steel structure in the middle of the soccer stadium here at the StubHub Center. Carlene Fuhrer finishing up her second snail push, and she's getting back to the rope for two more rope climbs. But that is your leader, Turi Helgadottir, who has led from the very beginning of this event.
And still looking just so smooth on these rope climbs, nice and strong. Smart athlete, when you have that much time to run, really, you should be really shaking the arms up, being ready. And for Camila Blanc-Bazinet right next to her, who is very proficient on rope climbs, just to compare and see how much different that looks. You just see Camila really being methodical and, you know, cautious.
Camila Blanc-Bazinet onto her third and final berm run. Turi Helgadottir onto her final rope climb of this event. All that remains is a 40-foot snail push across the finish line. Helgadottir, as she came into this round, had about a 21-second lead on China Cho. And Turi Helgadottir, all by herself, 40 more feet to cross, but here comes China Cho. And you saw Turi Helganov basically just shoulder check that thing. And China Cho all of a sudden has come out of nowhere to close the gap, but Helgadottir has her snail moving. Helgadottir's on the left, Cho is on the right, and Turi Helgadottir only has about 5 feet to go. And then she has to run across the finish line, and Turi Helgadottir will take heat number one. China Cho is going to lock up second place. 13 minutes, 19.56 seconds for Helgadottir, and now China Cho comes across in second, leading Carleen Matthews, Christy Adkins, and Sheila Barton fighting for third in the heat. 13:29.68 seconds for China Cho.
China Cho came out of nowhere. Oh, we didn't even see it, but she flew up. Must have flew up the rope.
And that's the difference. China Cho has shown that she is extremely proficient in rope climbing. This is the battle for third. It's between Carleen Matthews, Christy Adkins, and Sheila Barton. And Carleen Matthews will be the first woman among those three back to the snail.
And watch Carleen Matthews again. That low hit and just keep the snail moving is the key. You don't want to have to generate more power. Now she's letting her hands get a little high. Look at the difference in her body position. She's almost all the way stood up straight, as opposed to Turi was all the way down low, almost as horizontal, parallel to the ground. Carleen Matthews is making this a little bit harder than she has to.
Christy Adkins and Candace Wagner. Adkins is in the yellow, Wagner is in the blue. They're back to the snail at the same time. This is going to be a race for fourth place between the two of them, as Carleen Matthews is going to finish third in this heat. As long as she can keep that thing moving across the finish line, only a couple of feet to go for Carleen Matthews. And then it's a sprint across the finish line. Matthews is done, and she will finish third in heat number one of two here in event eight. Climbing snail, Christy Adkins and Candace Wagner. Wagner looks like she's slightly ahead of Adkins. Wagner is in, and then a sprint across the finish line for her. Wagner will lock up fourth place, and now it's Christy Adkins in fifth.
What a cool event. I love that there's so many different components. You know, you can be really good on running or really good on the rope climb or really good on the snail, but it depends on where the order is and who's right next to you. Really neat event just to adapt to a new movement, a little technical on the rope climb and adjust there and push it really hard on the berm.
Sheila Barton is in the light blue. She is pushing that thing for all she is worth. Barton is one of the smaller athletes in the field, just 5 feet tall, 133 pounds.
But even with that small, short frame, you don't want to use your leg. This isn't a movement where you want to use your leg. How about she's only had, you know, three attempts to really move this thing and figure it out.
Alethea Boone will come across the finish line. Boone will lock up seventh place in the heat. And now Emily Bridgers. She and Whitney Cappellucci, the next two ladies to come across the finish line, more than likely, as Emily Bridgers is in. And Bridgers will get herself across the finish line. Whitney Cappellucci getting set to finish up, and she's just choosing to roll her hands to the top of this and move it in just small increments, but she gets the job done. And she is in. Matthews and Helgadottir probably picking the best seat in the house in front of that fan. It is hot down there.
Cool off. Oh, the heat. We didn't talk about it, but heat is definitely a factor in this event. For that long, 20 minutes out there, 15-minute workout, that is, it's definitely going to be one that kind of gasses you, and you're going to have to recover well after this one. Get your body heat down, hydrate, definitely just recover for all that you've lost.
Christina Seely is now across the finish line, and here's Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet. The 2014 fittest woman on earth came into this event in 24th place, and for the second straight year, Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet got off to a slow start, and it has hurt her here on Saturday.
She has movements that she's really, really good at, and then there's some things that just she just needs a little more time to just figure out. She's not the biggest athlete out there, but she moves heavy weight on the barbell, but sometimes these odd objects, some athletes just aren't as strong in adapting to some of that grunt work.
Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet trying to get her snail across the finish line. And Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet is in. 21-minute time cap. Alexis Johnson is still on the floor line with Meg Reardon, Carly Fuhrer, and then the nine-time Gates veteran, Becca Voigt. That's Meg Reardon who's trying to get across the finish line. Aaliyah Helmick, whose husband is also competing in the men's division, just came across the finish line. And that's Carly Fuhrer and Alexis Johnson. Fuhrer has the headband on. She's closest to your screen. Alexis Johnson is next to her. Johnson has got to get across the finish line in order to stop the clock, and now Carly Fuhrer is in. And only a couple women left on the floor here. That is Madeline Sturt, the youngest competitor in the field here.
And at this point, she's just trying to breathe, get herself recovered so that when she gets back to the rope, when she gets to the snail, you know, she doesn't have any excuse to stand there and wait. She's going to get that recovery here and still keep moving.
19 years old for Madeline Sturt. She is with the best of the best here, but the fact that she was able to make it to the games at that age, this is not the last that we've heard from her. She has a bright future here.
Madeline Sturt reported she had a stomach bug actually as early as Tuesday. So those Wednesday events at the ranch, she was already fighting an uphill battle. She's put in a tremendous effort, but you can see the result here after all this volume. And with that at the beginning of her game, she's not doing well.
Thank you, Rory. Rory McKernan on the competition floor as well. And you can tell Madeline Sturt is not feeling 100%. This is kind of a surprise. This is Stacy Tovar finishing up.
You know, I think, Sean, this year has been such a different games than we've seen Stacy Tovar compete in. I really think this year the CrossFit Games caught up to all the athletes' fitness levels. In some ways, I think their fitness has had surpassed the competition in a little way. And I think that some of these athletes that we were used to seeing on top of the leaderboard, used to seeing perform a little bit better, they're really having a little gut check this year, because this is a really grueling test this year with very different tests and struggles that they have, you know, mentally and physically.
This has been one of the cooler stories we've been able to follow in this competition. This is Jen Smith. She injured her foot on the very first event on Wednesday in Aromas. She couldn't participate anymore that day. She basically walked her way through Murph yesterday, but she is refusing to quit. Right now, points don't matter for Jen Smith. It is her against this test, and she wants to make it the entire way through.
Sometimes it's not always the way you expect things to go, how people are going to remember you, but people will remember her gutsy performance. They're going to remember when they have an injury or when something, maybe they're having a battle. Look at the way she just pushes off of one leg, or pushes off that one foot, that one good foot. So impressive, so inspiring.
She has 10 seconds to get across the finish line. It won't happen. The crowd doesn't care, because every time Jen Smith is doing something on the floor, she gets a loud ovation from the crowd here at the StubHub Center. And she's still able to leave with a smile as Jen Smith continues to fight. Turi Helgadottir, though, blew through this event. 13 minutes, 19.56 seconds, looking for her first career event win here at the CrossFit Games. But Carlene Matthews also had a solid event. She finished third in this heat.
She was just very consistent. You know, there was no one place where she struggled, and there was no one place where she really excelled. She was just very smooth throughout. Didn't have the best technique on the snail, but did get the job done. Just took a little more effort than Turi Helgadottir. In second place, though, China Cho, she really came out of nowhere on her last round. It was because of her strength and her speed on the rope climbs that got her that to close the gap that Turi Helgadottir had. She finished up just behind Turi Helgadottir with a little bit of a race, but really, Turi Helgadottir, from the very first snail push, was where she was the first one to that movement, and from there didn't look back. She had a lead that was very sizable. She was quick on the rope climbs, but it was her adaptation and the way that she tackled the snail and learned on the fly and really had the most power that she could keep that snail and was the fastest on the snail. That's where, you know, all three movements, she was awesome, but she really did adapt quickly. It really made this thing look easy.
And then we had a bit of excitement as China Cho was able to fly up and down on those final two rope climbs, put a little pressure on Turi Helgadottir, but Turi gets the win in heat number one of climbing snail, and she is with Nikki Brazier.
Turi, the big monkey wrench in that obviously was the snail. We'd seen it, but you never had a chance to use it before you were in the event. We all want to know, what was it like pushing that snail?
It was actually much easier than I thought it would be.
Oh.
Yeah. my plan was to just run into it and kind of get it going, and it worked really well. And then, yeah, I got it going, and then I just walked. It wasn't that heavy.
We saw you kind of like shoulder check it to get it going. And also, tell me about that rope 5 feet off the ground. Have you ever practiced like that before?
No. It was just a few legless rope climbs and then with the feet, so yeah, it was fun.
You did a great job adapting. Congratulations. Thank you very much.
Turi Helgadottir leaving the soccer field here at the StubHub Center in Carson, California with what she hoped will be her first career event win here. One more heat to go as the top 10 women take to the field. We'll be back.
CrossFit genera comunidad y CrossFit hace que la gente sea mejor, que se mejore. Y creo que es poder llevar lo que hacemos adentro del box y alcanzar a la gente que no tiene la posibilidad de venir al box.
Acérquense que explico lo que vamos a hacer.
Es eso de ocuparse por nosotros, de ocuparse de transmitir esto que hacemos, ocuparse por las cosas correctas, las personas correctas y las causas correctas. Y poder llegar a ellos y ver que ellos cómo lo sienten, cómo lo viven también y cómo lo agradecen a su manera es gratificante por todos lados. El dolor de hoy es la fuerza de mañana. Puede estar lloviendo, puede hacer frío, pero solo pensar en esa sonrisa de esos chicos hace que valga todo la pena.
I've had my right hip replaced, left hip, left knee. After my last surgery, I came here and saw what was going on. I was scared. I lost 20 pounds. My range of motion has changed. Each day it's a challenge, but you have to think positive because I'm not ready to die yet, and I'm trying to keep hope alive.
I cannot hear Sean.
Women on Earth in event number 8 here at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. It is climbing snail, the first new challenge, a rope climb with a rope that dangles 5 feet above the floor. The other is the snail. I am Sean Woodland alongside 2009 CrossFit Games champion Tanya Wagner. The event, climbing snail.
These ladies are going to have to perform 3 rounds of a 500-meter berm run and then a 40-foot snail push with a 400-pound object right there that is named the snail, made by Rogue Fitness. Every time these athletes run through the rig on the field, under the rig, passing it to go on the run or coming back to the snail, they will have to perform 2 rope climbs. It'll be a total of 10 rope climbs throughout the duration of this event.
That snail is a brand new object here for the CrossFit Games, and Rory McKernan has more.
400 pounds on an evenly loaded sled would not be that much for these women, so why is it so arduous? Well, take out the guts of this thing. We've got a barrel half filled with sand, so intentionally not filled to capacity. What that does is it makes it extremely awkward. You can never turn over the momentum. I got my hands on this thing earlier and actually had a decent amount of success at the women's weight, but when I finally cracked the code, it looked like Helga Daughter from last heat. You have to get extremely low and stay low. Women that come up high, it looks like one of those boxing rigs where you hit it and it comes back at you. This thing doesn't roll very far unless you maintain the momentum on it by staying low.
Thank you, Ro. And anytime you have rope climbs, a movement that requires a lot of pulling and running, a woman you have to keep your eyes on is Samantha Briggs, and she's in this heat.
Samantha Briggs, she's sitting in third place after 3 days of competition, and that's after taking a 33rd yesterday in a strength event. She's had two events that have been strength components out of seven, and she's still in that third place position, and here's an opportunity for her to gain more points.
Second of two heats here. And the overall leaders will be in the middle of the floor. Keep an eye on lanes number 12 and 13. Carl Webb and Katrin Davis' daughter working right next to each other.
Carl Webb, this athlete really loves anything raw strength, grunt work, and she's gonna have an opportunity on that snail to show us what she can do there. It's hot down the soccer field, but this athlete likes the hotter the better, the warmer the better from Australia. She's used to the classic CrossFit types events, and this is just that for her.
Katrin Davis' daughter is your defending champion. She currently comes in fourth place overall, looking to climb into the top three.
And I'm nervous for this event after coming off of a first place win last night in double DT. She has her work cut out for her with that rope. In the past, it's proved to be a struggle for her. We'll see if she's been able to overcome. She's worked in the off season really hard on that. We'll see what she can do.
Heat 2 of event number 8 is underway. It's climbing snail, and it starts with a 500-meter run up and over the berm here at the soccer stadium at the StubHub Center in Carson, California. It is hot down there, and this is the first time in this competition that the athletes have had to deal with the heat here in Carson.
They've had 3 days of competition. Their bodies are definitely feeling the fatigue and they're banged up, but now they have to kind of put that behind them. They have to adapt to the weather and to the new element of the snail. And so your mind has to stay sharp in competition. You have to be just as strong on day 4 and 5 as you are on day 1. But the heat, they really haven't seen the heat since Wednesday in Aromas when they did that 7K trail run.
They got a bit of a taste of it yesterday, but the majority of the events occurring on Friday were 1 in the morning, that was Murph, the long event, and then at night they had a couple more of those over in the soccer stadium, and most of it under the lights. They didn't have to deal with the sun that is blazing here in Southern California.
For this 3-round event, though, they're not really as concerned with the heat as they are about just getting that first round under their belt. They can get a feel for what this event is going to feel like and how they have to tackle the second round. Really, that second round is really important. In the previous heat, it was really important and crucial to make your movement, because there's just not a lot of time. Even though it's a longer event, there's not a lot of places where you can make moves.
Anna Tunnicliffe in the long pants and shorts. Over those is first down the stairs. Kristen Holta, though, just passing her. She was in the yellow sports top. Sam Briggs, Lauren Fisher, Katrin Davis' daughter, Teja Percevich, Tenille Reed, Tia Toomey, who's your overall leader. She'll be wearing the white jersey to signify that she is on top of the overall leaderboard, all finishing up that first 500-meter run, and they have to go back through their lane and work their way to the rig. So we're going to tell who's really in the lead when they get to the rope climbs, and here's a shocker. It's Sam Briggs on the left of your screen, just ahead of Holta and Tunnicliffe.
Sam Briggs had the early lead in Murph yesterday and lost it on this same field to some of the other athletes. And so she's not looking for that to happen. She's very strong on these rope climbs. But the other ladies in the field have gotten a lot better at legless rope climbs as well. The best news for these girls is once they get halfway up the rope, they can use their legs.
Kristen Holta has completed one. There's two rope climbs here, and then it is on to that snail that weighs 400 pounds. That's Tia Toomey, who is your overall leader. You mentioned that they can use your legs, but the trick is getting them secured, because you don't have a lot of weight counterbalancing that rope when you get up the top.
For Tia Toomey, this wasn't even necessarily a test of endurance or strength. For her, she told me this was a test of who can adapt best on the fly. And she said she was looking forward to figuring out exactly how to move this snail and very glad that all the ladies were on the same page as she was.
It's Tenille Reed on the right of your screen at the top, in the dark blue top, who is in the lead. She's got to cross that dark gray line, and then she'll take off back to the rig and do two more rope climbs, and then start round number two. So Tenille Reed, the Games rookie, who comes in eighth place overall, now on to her first of her final two rope climbs in this round. The athletes can make the touch anywhere on that steel, but there's a black line on the rope. They have to keep their hands on the rope until they reach that black line, and then they can hop off and hit the pad at the bottom.
And Tenille Reed is coming in eighth place. It is tight at the top of the leaderboard, so all these points matter. She's looking to gain as many as possible. If she can stay ahead of the pack, that's going to be very impressive. If she can keep that speed on the snail for her second two rounds, that's going to be an awesome push against the previous heat winner, Turi Helgadottir.
Every woman except Jamie Hagia has finished up her first snail push. And that's Annie Thorsdottir, who right now is in third place in this heat.
Barely getting a foot there on the edge of the rope, and this is what we were talking about. A little different with it being so short. Annie is known for her very efficient climbing when she gets to use her legs. She does a big pull, saves her arm, does a big setup. Just not as easy to do with a short rope.
Tenille Reed is the first woman back to the run. Carrie Pierce on the left of your screen trying to chase her down. Reed making her way up the stairs, but the woman behind her is going to pass her here pretty soon, and that's Sam Briggs. That's because she is chewing up steps, and Briggs now coming into the frame is going to have the lead as we begin round number two. The time to beat belongs to Turi Helgadottir. She did this event in 13 minutes, 19.56 seconds.
But now, that Sean, you know, Sam had that lead in the run coming off the first run. The advantage for Tenille Reed, though, is that they don't have to go back for the fine for two more rope climbs. Sam Briggs makes up the distance on the run and the rope climbs. If they did that so far in the first round, so Sam's gonna have to pick up that speed on the snail, assuming that Reed keeps her pace.
Samantha Briggs is just about to the top of the berm, and now she's starting her trip down back into the soccer stadium. Meanwhile, Tenille Reed, the woman who started this run in the lead, is just getting to the crest. Sam Briggs working her way down back into the soccer stadium as we approach the 6-minute mark. After this, it'll be two rope climbs, a 40-foot snail push, and then two more rope climbs, and then the third and final round for Samantha Briggs. Briggs won the opening event of the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. That was on Wednesday. She's finished in the top 10 so far 5 times, and just one event placement outside of the top 30. That was in the squat clean pyramid yesterday, where she finished 33rd.
I'm a little surprised that Tenille slowed down that run. She's an endurance athlete who made her move to CrossFit, so it's not like, you know, running is new for her. That is a struggle. I'm wondering if she went out a little bit too hard, though, a little too aggressive.
Sam Briggs up her first of two rope climbs, and then onto the snail, and Briggs comes into this event ahead of that woman, trailing that woman, I should say, by 6 points. That's Sarah Sigmund's daughter. Sarah Sigmund's daughter sits in second place overall. She's 4 points behind Tia Toomey for the overall lead. Sam Briggs is 10 points out of the lead, but just 6 points ahead of Sarah Sigmund's daughter. The winner of this event gets 100 points. If Sam Briggs can hang on to that, and Sarah Sigmund's daughter gets second place, they will be tied in points.
Now Sam Briggs takes that one shoulder and digs in. You know, I'd love to see her just kind of hit it with both hands a little bit lower. She's a bit high on the snail.
Briggs would actually take a 2-point lead over Sigmund's daughter if they finish first and second in this event. But Briggs is your leader. She's in the left. Sarah Sigmund's daughter getting back to the snail. She is in second place. The most important thing for both of these women is that they are ahead of Tia Toomey, who is on the left In the middle of your screen, she's on the right box on the left side, working her way up the rope. So either Sarah Sigmund's daughter or Sam Briggs could overtake Tia Toomey for the overall lead after eight events.
This has been just, you know, all over the board for the athletes as far as who takes first in seven events so far. And Sarah Sigmund's daughter has had no placement outside of 17th, while all the other ladies in the top five have places outside of 22nd. So Sigmund's are very consistent at the top.
Sam Briggs back up on her first of two rope climbs, one to go, and then it's one final run, and you know you're not going to catch her on that portion. And here comes Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Tennille Reed, also returning. Carrie Pierce is walking back.
Sarah Sigmund's daughter is very fast on these rope climbs. If you remember the Meridian region, you were there, Sean. Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Annie Thor's daughter, there's a race. Sam Briggs was there up the rope. So Sarah Sigmund's daughter will have no problem on the rope. I just don't know if she'll be able to catch Sam on the run.
Tia Toomey, with 486 total points, is your overall leader. You get 100 points for a win. You get 94 for a second place, and then the farther down you finish, the fewer points you receive.
Look at how fatigued she is. Look at how hard she's breathing. That's because of that constant pressure you're under and the tension that you're under to push that 400-pound snail that's all uneven as you're pushing.
Sam Briggs is off on her final berm run. In the seven events that we've seen so far, no one has won more than one event. Sam Briggs looking to be the first woman to win two events here at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. Chrissy Aramo, the Games rookie, as an individual, working her way back up the top, trying to put some pressure on Carrie Pierce and Sarah Sigmund's daughter. Sigmund's daughter's off on the run, as is Carrie Pierce, and Chrissy Aramo is right behind the two of them. That is your leader in this heat. She's trying to chase down Turi Helgadottir's winning time of 13 minutes, 19.56 seconds.
Samantha Briggs had a tough time making sure she was going to be able to come here for the games from overseas. And she was telling me earlier she was really hoping that that stressful week before the games wouldn't affect her performance. As you can see, far ahead in the lead here, she still seems to be doing a good job.
While many of the athletes came to California and other parts in the Southwest, Las Vegas, some parts in Northern California to get acclimated to the heat, Sam Briggs literally showed up a couple days before this competition started.
Sam Briggs spent a lot of time, though, over here. She's comfortable here. You know, she's previous games winner. This is her fifth games. It's more like home when you get here for Sam.
Sam Briggs making the final descent into the soccer stadium. Two rope climbs and then a final snail push of 40 feet. And she is on pace to win event number eight and most likely get herself on top of the overall leaderboard. Meanwhile, on the right, Sarah Sigmund's daughter, who is in second place, is getting passed by Carrie Pierce for second place. Chrissy Aramo is behind her, and Kristen Holta in the yellow behind Aramo. But on the bottom left, there goes Sam Briggs, who's finally locking in her legs. Probably could have done that whole thing legless. Makes the touch, and she'll have one more to go before a final 40-foot snail push. Again, you see the black line at the top on the rope. That's where the athletes have to have their hands on the rope as they decline down towards the pad before they can drop off.
But it is smart to drop. You don't want to hold on any longer than you have to. Save that grip.
Sarah Sigmund's daughter has passed Carrie Pierce as the two of them are followed by Kristen Holta and Chrissy Aramo. But doesn't look like anybody's going to catch Sam Briggs here. She just has 40 feet to go with that 400-pound snail. And Sam Briggs looking to become the first woman this year to win two events. And there's a very good chance Samantha Briggs could move herself into first place. It depends where Tia Toomey and Sarah Sigmund's daughter finish.
So much composure, so much confidence with Sam Briggs when she gets out there and gets on a run. That was a good hit, much better than that shoulder push that she did earlier.
Briggs inching her way to the finish line. More than a minute to go before we hit Turi Helgadottir's top time. The crowd trying to bring Samantha Briggs home. And it's going to be event win number two. for Samantha Briggs, the ninth event win of her CrossFit Games career, and she will earn 100 points. Carrie Pierce is second back to the stale. And this is good for Briggs because he only needs a couple people to finish between herself and Tia Toomey in order to overtake the top spot in the overall standings. Tia Toomey is currently in ninth place in this heat. Carrie Pierce just about done. Christy Aramo in the wrong pan, so at the top of your screen is behind her. So Carrie Pierce will get in and she will finish second in the heat, second in the event. Christy Aramo is in.
And this is all good news for Sam Briggs, as Sarah Sigmund's daughter has now dropped this far back.
And Catherine David's daughter is on the left. She has passed Sarah Sigmund's daughter. David's daughter will get in. She only trailed Sigmund's daughter by 10 points. Sigmund's daughter needs to hurry up and get across the finish line. Kristen Holt is going to beat her there, and that's going to cost Sarah Sigmund's daughter. Those are valuable points that Sarah Sigmund's daughter just missed out on. Go ahead.
Didn't even look like she knew that Holt was there and came out of nowhere. Sarah stayed in her lane and was just so focused on that snail.
Sigmund's daughter will finish eighth in the event. That's going to be good for 68 points. David's daughter finished fourth. That's good for 84. So David's daughter is going to jump ahead of Sigmund's daughter. As Alessandra Pacelli just came across the finish line. Tenille Reed is in. 21-minute time cap, but it doesn't look like it's going to be much of an issue for anybody on the field right now. Good. Tia Toomey has yet to finish. And that means that Samantha Briggs is going to be your overall leader after eight events. As Toomey just looks gassed, just resting her head on a snail right there.
And I hate to say this, but I think back to the men's competition last year with Matt Fraser, and this was the event when, you know, there was a similar event with that big heavy pig. The athletes that have the lead, and sometimes this unknown element comes up and they just can't adapt as quickly as the other competitors.
Toomey is in. She finished 13th. That's good for 54 points. And Annie Thor's daughter is in. She'll get 16th in the event. Just 2 seconds behind Tasia Persevich.
Thor's daughter last night on social media said, okay, now it's time to get serious. Only 2 days left in competition. She came into today in ninth place. That's not going to help her score too much.
That is Lauren Fisher, who now has just 20 feet to go to close out her event.
And look how high she is. Just hasn't been able to figure out how to stay low, how to get yourself more parallel to the ground. She's hinged at the hips, so really isn't using much of her lower body because she's lost the power as soon as she bends like that.
Jamie Hickey, meanwhile, is way behind. This is only her second snail push, so the 21-minute time cap is certainly going to be an issue for her.
Way behind, you know, slow on every portion. She was struggling earlier on the rope climbs.
Margot Alvarez is in lane number four. She has yet to finish, as does Caroline Rees and Tebow. That's Margot Alvarez. Michelle LeConner still on the field as well, as is Carl Webb.
It's easy for us to say that you need to just be pushing from the bottom, get low. But when you're breathing that hard, the only way to get your oxygen is to stand tall and to open your chest up. And that's the last thing that these ladies want to do, is to kind of come back, compact that, and crush yourself.
I beg your pardon. Carl Webb was just walking back to gather some equipment. She is actually done. She finished ninth in the heat and 11th in the event. Margot Alvarez will finish. Now, Brooke Wells is having a problem here.
On paper, looking at this event, you know, she's a powerhouse. I would have expected her to dominate on the snail. She can run. That's not an issue for her. She knows how to rope climb. So sometimes it's also the way you put movements together when they can just be crippling, and it looks like that's what this did for Wells.
Three women left on the floor, one of whom is Emily Abbott. 4 minutes to go before we hit the 21-minute time cap. And this is the portion of the event where Abbott is going to do the best. She just excels at these sort of weird object, grunt work type of movements.
Emily Abbott is one of those athletes that just has fun out there. She's like, I don't want to say she doesn't take it too seriously, but because she is a very serious athlete, but she has fun. She puts her heart into it. You can kind of read the emotion in her when she's working out.
Emily Abbott will get herself across the finish line. Last year, she had a career best eighth place finish at the CrossFit Games. It was only her second appearance here in Carson, California. Just two women left, Brooke Wells and Jamie Haguia. But Sam Briggs wins this event, and the next time we see a jersey on her back, it's most likely going to be the white leader's jersey.
These athletes don't know what they have ahead of them tonight. They know they will be having an event or multiple events. They won't know until later today, but they do know they have more ahead of them.
But Brooke Wells is an extremely capable athlete. We know she has potential to win an event. She did just that on Wednesday when she won the ranch deadlift ladder. But she's the only woman in the regional competition. That is the competition that decides who gets themselves over here to Carson, California to compete in the CrossFit Games. She was the only woman to win three of the seven events but not win the regional.
Well, she took a first on the ranch deadlift ladder. She took a second in the ranch mini chipper, second in the deadlift in double DT last night. So she definitely is capable. It's just seeming like this event really has found some of her weakness, especially when you put them together.
Brooke Wells, with about 2.5 minutes to go before we hit the time cap, Jamie Haguia has one rope climb to go before she gets back to the snail for a final 40-foot push. So if she can find another gear, she has a chance to get herself inside that 21-minute time cap and across the finish line.
This event, again, it's an event that really your lung capacity has to be there. It hurts so bad inside, just what's going on. It's something you can't see necessarily on the athletes. You can't really tell it, but the tension underneath that you've been holding on to move that snail just really does catch up to you.
Sean, I made the short haul over to the athlete warm-up area to talk with the veteran athletes from the former heat, and they said surprisingly universally that the worm really wasn't that big of a deal. They said rope climbs are always really, really difficult, and the berm's always the berm. That was from Alethea Boone. What they all appreciated was the fact that with this rope standard and with this implement, it's like the CrossFit Games at its best. None of them could have or got the chance to practice this event in advance, and they all loved that.
Thank you, Rotator Percevich, Sunil Reed, Michelle Otondra, trying to find some cool air as Jamie Haguia is trying to find a way to the top of that rope. There's a white cooler full of water that's at basically every post of that giant steel structure known as Zeus in the middle of the field, and Haguia went to that to cool herself off. It is hot on that competition floor. Margo Alvarez trying to coach Haguia through this final rope climb. And Haguia will not be able to make it. So less than a minute to go before we hit the time cap.
Probably won't be enough time for her to regain some strength there and let everything cool off in her forearms.
Brooke Wells and Jamie Haguia look to be the only two women who will not finish this event in this heat inside the 21-minute time cap, as Brooke Wells has two rope climbs to go. We're not exactly certain who's going to wind up on top of the leaderboard. We have a very good idea that it's going to be Samantha Briggs, but of course that's all unofficial. But I think one thing we can say with certainty is that the top of the leaderboard is going to look a lot different than it did coming into this event.
And that's what we always say, you know, don't get too comfortable in day one or two of competition and people get a little bit excited about who's on top of the leaderboard. It's a long competition. The athletes know that too.
And Jamie Haguia will not be able to make it through the event, but thanking the crowd for helping her through her effort. But that woman, Samantha Briggs, wins her second event here at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games and does it in 12 minutes, 30.44 seconds. The woman goes under 13 minutes, the only woman in the field, and this is where she took over and never looked back.
Once she took over Tanel Reed's spot in first there, she didn't look back, just ran away with this thing. She's so fast on the runs, which we know, very consistent, one and two up and down the rope climbs, and it was this snail. She adapted, quickly figured out how to do that. She's usually good with those raw type movements, not as technical. She can figure them out quickly. She did just that for all three rounds. There was nobody near her.
Maybe didn't have the most efficient technique on that snail, but it didn't matter because she was so fast on the other movements, and Samantha Briggs is with Nikki Brazier.
Sam, you've proven over and over that you can excel and adapt, but today with that snail that you've never been able to touch before, I mean, what was going through your mind when you first got your hands on it?
I just kind of ran at it, got low with the shoulder, and thought, take it like a tackle dummy, try to get it moving. I'm not as heavy as some of the other girls, so it was kind of give it a good push. and then don't let it stop, because to get it moving again, I'm not sure I'd have been able to do that.
At this event, win is enough to rocket you back to the top of the leaderboard. What kind of fuel does that put in your belly to make it to the podium?
Obviously, it's awesome to go out there in the leader's jersey, but it's still early days. We've still got a lot more workouts to do. So I'll just take the win from that workout and concentrate on the next.
Sounds good. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Top four from last year are the top four this time, but only in different orders. Samantha Briggs finished fourth of the games last year. She's now on top of the overall leaderboard. Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Catherine David's daughter, second and third, and Tia Toomey drops to fourth. For all the latest updates, athlete interviews, and videos from the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games, head to games.crossfit.com.
What's up, everyone on site and online? Welcome back. We are coming to you live from the Reebok CrossFit Games. I'm Allison Hagendorf, now here with Tommy Marquez, the accurate predictor of the women's event 8 victor. Samantha Briggs was your pick.
Yep, every once in a while I get one right, you know?
You're getting it right.
If you throw enough darts at the board, you're going to hit a bullseye. Yeah, this event was pretty exciting to watch because of the new implement in the snail. And pretty early on, we saw Sam charge out to kind of the front on that berm run. This is an event, you know, a lot of these elements worked in her favor. And really, when it came to this snail, you saw her moving her hands quickly. You saw a lot of athletes try and take big heaves, and it wasn't very successful for her. Sam kept the pace going, kept her hands moving on that snail, was able to walk away with an event victory. And everyone loves Sam Briggs. When she crosses the finish, people go absolutely insane. So a great finish for her to move her up to the top.
All right, well, let's see where we're at right now with the women. Do we have that? Here we go.
Oh, man, Sam Briggs taking the lead. I love it. That's such a great story from her. We weren't thinking she was going to make it here. You know, all of a sudden she shows up, and now she's in first place halfway through Saturday. So an exciting story, you know, and obviously there's a huge battle right behind her with a bunch of the other athletes. We saw a strong performance from Carrie Pierce in event number 8. You know, Turi Helgadottir, first time we're seeing her name at the top of the leaderboard in terms of an event finish. So some nice finishes. Christy Aramo, a great weekend so far. So it's nice to see another strong finish from her as well.
Well, Samantha made the snail look easy, and the women set the stage with this new object. How will the men do with the snail?
Well, talking about the men, looking at this event, obviously there's a couple people you want to talk about. Matt Frazier being one of them. You look at the workout that really messed him up last year was the soccer chipper. Right. You're talking about an odd object and then some legless rope climbs. It was a triplet. Now we have another odd object in the snail, some more hybrid rope climbs, so a little bit of legless, you get a pinch at the top. But this time I think it's going to be a little bit different story for him. So it's a great kind of redemption type workout to kind of show everyone that he's holding onto this first place position. He is the man, he's the fittest man on earth. And then the one dark horse that I think can unseat him in this is Jacob Heppner.
Yeah.
He's a guy who, very similar to Sam Briggs, is a grinder. And we saw how successful Sam was with the snail. And Heppner is a guy who is a great runner, and he's not afraid of rope climbs. Just the other day, me and Pat Sherwood posted a workout online that we did 60 rope climbs over 30 minutes. And Heppner replied, oh, yeah, I did an AMRAP of 30 minutes rope climbs, and I got 119. So he's averaging 4 a minute for just about half an hour.
It's amazing.
He's an absolute madman. So I think this workout is right up in his wheelhouse, and I think this is another opportunity for him to make a big push.
Absolutely. Guys, we're going to take a very quick break, and when we come back, we'll be here with a very special guest.
Yeah. back down. That's one rep there. 7 rounds for time. Hands outside of the thighs. Feet are underneath the hips. Then I jump.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm here now with a very special guest, Jolie Gentry. Wow. Thank you for coming on. This is the winner of the inaugural CrossFit Games. I just wanted to know, what is it like to witness this transformation of the games from the beginning?
Oh, it's unreal, really, Allison. Just the venue comparison is out of this world. I mean, we started basically in Dave's parents' backyard. You know, the ranch was just a small grassroots event in 2007, and then every year it exponentially transformed into something more and more amazing until the venue we're at today. I mean, we've been here for many years, but wow, every year it has outdone itself. You know, the vendor village, the caliber of athlete, that's probably, other than the event itself, is the most amazing transformation of all. Taking an athlete like myself back in 2007 does not compare to the level of men and women that we're seeing on the floor today. They are just unbelievable, the things that they're doing. I'm envious of some of the events that they get to try out there.
Like what? What's an event that you would love to do?
Oh, man. Double DT or just something, all these odd objects that they get to try are really cool. That snail event that we just witnessed was just something new, unique. They started back in, I think it was 08 or 09, trying with, you know, something new and different. We had the hammer smash back in the day. That does not compare to the innovative products that Rogue is making and, the vendors that are working hand in hand with CrossFit.
Yeah. What role does CrossFit and fitness in general continue to play in your life?
Oh, it is an essential part of my life. I continue to be a law enforcement officer.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you. Kind of a tough time to be in my line of work right now, but proud to say that I'm a team leader on my SWAT team, and it's critical that fitness remains an essential part of my life and everyone on my team. As you guys know, we have to maintain hypervigilance out there right now. It's absolutely critical to make sure that you have prepared yourself to always be ready.
Yes.
And you never know.
All right. CrossFit really emphasizes gender equality from the athletes to the staff. What impact do you think that CrossFit has made on gender equality in sports in general?
I think CrossFit has differentiated itself in the fact that it is gender equal. You know, the prizes are equal across the board. And the way they promote, it's not just the face of the men that you see out there. You see the faces of the men and women, and that really touches my heart to know that, everybody's being represented equally. It's really beautiful.
Now, as an athlete and as a woman, CrossFit has changed my life. You know, what role do you think CrossFit is playing for women in sort of changing stereotypical and traditional societal expectations and what we're supposed to look like or not look like? What role do you think CrossFit plays in that?
I think it's helping people realize that, strong is beautiful, to take a quote from, you know, an old Valley CrossFit mantra from years ago. And that CrossFit, as you look around this venue today and throughout the whole CrossFit community, strength plays a huge part in creating a new type of beautiful for women.
I think that society is always telling women to be less, to be smaller, to be thinner, to be tinier. And with CrossFit, it's about just being your best version of yourself.
That's right.
So thanks. I'll
absolutely
do that. Exactly. Well, thank you so much for
thank
coming.
You.
I know everyone's excited to see you and to hear your insight.
Can I just say, if anybody would like to come out to my booth, I'll be out at the 5'11 tactical booth with Christmas Abbott and Andy Stump and some of the other 5'11 ambassadors.
Awesome.
I'd like to see you out there.
I'm definitely coming to that. And guys, of course, make sure you're heading to the Vendor Village. So much fun stuff. We'll definitely check out that booth. We also have the Fit Expo stage. We're going to check out that calendar right here. Yep. We got aerobic capacity, which always, like, I love that. That's I'm all about the engine. CrossFit rowing and, of course, barbells for boobs. An amazing, amazing cause. It's really important for awareness. And coming up, we have the updated Saturday competition schedule, Men Event 8. We're going to see how the men do with this now. And, of course, the Dave Castro announcement to find out what's going on with the afternoon schedule. And, guys, keep those pictures coming. This is such an important part of the weekend. Make sure you're using the hashtag CrossFit, CrossFit Games, CFG10 to honor the 10 years of the CrossFit Games. Here we go. I love seeing all the fans. These are some of the pictures that you guys submitted. Do not stop sending them. Bald is beautiful right there. Looking good.
Ron Ortiz, Masters athlete right there, showing up with some fans. I love that view of the entire soccer stadium with the Zeus rig.
Oh, I love that.
People
that
flexing out their strength there in Vendor Village. Some Hillary Froning, a bunch of different people showing up from all sorts of different walks of life in different areas in the country.
That's
just some
right.
awesome
it's a good
stuff.
Good looking crew, must add. All right, guys, Men's Event 8 is next. We'll see you in a bit.
Forward.
Boom. Does CrossFit make women look too bulky?
My honest thoughts?
No. How are we supposed to look?
No other place have they focused on helping women to understand their full capacity.
It's helping redefine our cultural concept of beauty.
I feel beautiful in my body no matter what.
It's changed my life in a very positive way.
Day four of the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games for the Individuals begins with a brand new piece of equipment in Climbing Snail. Thanks for joining us, everybody. I'm Sean Woodland. Alongside Bill Grundler, Sam Farber will be joining us in a moment from the competition floor. But a couple new challenges here in the event that we are calling the Climbing Snail.
Yeah, if you look at what the description is, you see some normal things, some running, some rope climbs, but the snail push. This is what's most exciting about the CrossFit Games for me, is what kind of crazy things are they going to pull out. And this is a very interesting one. You can see that big round object. And this is going to be very interesting.
That thing weighs 500 pounds. And for more on what goes into it, literally, here's Sam Farber.
Yeah, it's not a true 500-pound cylinder. It is about a 160-pound cylinder filled with sand to make the weight. Now, the women just competed in this event. They had 100 pounds less of sand, so during the intermission, the staff here was filling them up. I can tell you, looking inside, it's still only about a third filled. And after the women's competition, several women said, you know, I thought it was going to be tougher. Might want to be careful saying things like that. They might fill it up even more, guys.
Thanks, Sam. 20 men in this first of two heats here in event number 8 in lane 6, Con Porter. And in lane number 9 is Spencer Hendel. We know that those guys can handle the rope climbs.
You know, Spencer Hendel, he's a big athlete, so you naturally think strong. But just like he did last year in the weird object with the pig last year, he came out and was second overall. So he's a very athletic guy. I'm expecting to see some very cool adaptions from him. He always does well in these types of events.
And then Con Porter, the man who got himself here to the CrossFit Games with an outstanding performance in the final event of regionals, and that featured legless rope climb.
And this is exactly what he needs to do. Everyone's going to be able to push, but if you have good rope climbs, you're going to do amazing.
The event begins with a 500-meter run, and there is a unique challenge that is presented by that rope climb. We'll get to that in a second when the men reach the rope. But first, 500 meters up and over the berm here at the StubHub Center in Carson, California.
So as these guys are running, they're going to come straight out of their lane. So that's where it kind of gives that initial separation. So the guys up in the front aren't necessarily, quote unquote, in the front. They're just in that lane number 20 all the way to the one side. If you're in lane number 1, it looks like you're at the very end, but you're kind of even with everyone once we get down and around. So we start off with that berm run. You see them hitting those stairs immediately, and this instantly jacks your heart rate up. They get up to the very top of that berm, and it takes them around the big jumbotron. It flattens out, and then they get to basically recover as they come back down into the field.
That is Logan Collins, who is the first man to the top, but not necessarily the fastest man right now. Behind him is James Newbery, a Games rookie out of Australia. Roy Gamboa has been to the Games a couple of times. Jacob Anderson, Lucas Parker with the beard. More and more men getting to the top. Albert, Dominique LaRouche. Gary Helmick just passed out of your screen. His wife is competing as well as an individual for the women. Now the descent into the soccer stadium. And again, they have to go back to the lane from which they came. So there are lane assignments here. It's not a free-for-all. First come for a serve. Logan Collins, the first man down the steps, followed by James Newbery, Roy Gamboa, Jacob Anderson, Sean Sweeney, who's competed the entire time with a cowboy hat on. He'll be easy to spot. Con Porter behind him.
And all these athletes need to be really careful when they come down. They want to try to push the pace, but they don't want to come tumbling down those stairs. But again, you're not going to be able to pass a whole lot of those people down those stairs either. So you want to kind of get yourself moving and get yourself onto that field as fast as possible.
Logan Collins is going to be the first man back, along with Con Porter and Gary Helmick.
And there's the rope climb we were talking about. So you see, they start on that pad. That rope is 5 feet off the ground. So for most people, this isn't a legless rope climb. At least it's not called a legless rope climb. But you don't have any rope to use your legs with anyway. So you're forced to do a legless rope climb. And you can lock in up at the top if you want to.
Gary Helmick is through two.
And Con Porter will begin.
Con Porter, though, is first man to the snail. They got to push that 500-pound cylinder that's filled with sand 40 feet, then back to that giant steel structure in the middle of the competition floor known as Zeus, and do two more rope climbs, and then they'll start round number two.
Look at those big red cylinders in the middle of the field. Now here's what's happening. That sand, as you're driving forward, that sand starts to climb up the one side and slide back down to the bottom. So there never is an easy point with this cylinder. You can't gain any momentum. The object is just to keep on driving, keep on grinding, and get yourself to the end of that 40 feet.
Logan Collins is done. Sean Sweeney is finished. Sweeney's in the cowboy hat towards the top of your screen. Logan Collins was first, and then back to the rope, but they're all chasing this guy. That is Con Porter, who is done with his first of two rope climbs here to close out round number one. Sean Sweeney, Gary Helmick, and Marcus Philly all right behind Con Porter.
And you can see Logan Collins, when he came off the rope, it really kicked it out there pretty far, so we had to control the rope. That's going to be a management thing these athletes are all going to have to deal with.
Con Porter is off. He'll start round number two. Porter came in 29th place overall. His best finish at the CrossFit Games came in 2014 when he finished 27th. James Newbery, another Australian, is back on the run. Con Porter followed closely by Marcus Philly, Logan Collins, Sean Sweeney in the cowboy hat. Your top four right now.
And I'm surprised I don't see the athletes grabbing onto that rail and using that rail to move them, make their way up those stairs. This isn't a restricted thing to not be able to use that. So use it. It's to your advantage. The railing is there, especially in this section. You can use both hands on the rail to really help propel yourself up those stairs.
Collins and Sweeney are choosing to do just that. Marcus Philly has passed Con Porter here in round number two. 21-minute time cap on event eight. We know there are more events to come here on Saturday. We just don't know what. So the athletes, when they're done with this, kind of hard mentally to get prepared for what's coming when you don't know what it is.
Yeah, but it's the CrossFit game. That's what these guys are expecting, to not know what they're going to be hit with. And you know what? They started the whole week off like that, you know, having to get shipped up to Aromas.
Yeah, they've been dosed up these past 3 days. This is day number four, and they have already done a ton of work. Marcus Philly ahead of Con Porter as they begin their descent into the soccer stadium. Now Porter trying to pass Philly on the steps, and here comes Logan Collins. Sean Sweeney still in fourth place, and James Newbery in the blue shirt trying to catch up with that lead pack. Collins and Philly back in front. Philly's in the light blue shorts, the long hair. Con Porter behind him, Sean Sweeney, and now here comes James Newbery. Con Porter will be the first man to make the turn. He's followed by Marcus Philly. Logan Collins makes the turn, and Sean Sweeney. Four men working their way back to the rope.
Now, where Marcus Philly made up his distance on that last round was coming off the snail and immediately going into those two rope climbs. So I expect to see him hanging in there with Con Porter the whole time. And actually, look at that. He hopped up there on the rope first, very confident on the rope.
The athletes can touch any part of that steel structure, including the shackle. There's a black mark on the rope. They have to keep their hands on the rope on the descent until they hit that black mark. Then they can drop off.
And if you look right below Marcus Philly, you can see that black tape line. That's a section, if they want to drop, that's where they can drop from. So their hands have to come below there, and then they can choose to hop off the rope if they want to.
Con Porter's off. Marcus Philly's in the lead. 40 more feet on that snail.
Guys, one other aspect of this snail is how it's interacting with the elements here in Carson at StubHub Center. The thing is basically made of the same material as a tackling dummy. In the heat, the top of it is scorching hot to the point that our event team here, which has done a fantastic job, they're all wearing gloves to come out. I asked them afterwards what it's like. They said, it burns my hands if I'm not wearing the gloves. Think of it like sitting in a seat here at StubHub Center. If you're in the shade, it's hot, but it's manageable. If you're in the sun, it's very uncomfortable. You do not want your skin touching a seat any longer than it has to.
Thank you, Sam. Marcus Philly is in the lead, and he's back for two more rope climbs.
Look at that. He just attacks that rope. There's no rest. Very confident in his pull.
and choosing to use his feet. We've seen a couple men just go legless the whole way up because it's faster. But Marcus Philly is having no trouble securing his leg, which is a problem when you don't have an entire rope there.
You know, maybe. I mean, Marcus has been around a while. This short rope has been in the games before. So maybe he's tested that out and has something like that in his gym. Now, one of the things that I think is impressive is the fact that driving that snail is going to use a lot of those big driving muscles, your hips, your glutes, your hamstrings, blowing all the oxygen in your blood, and then you have to resort to small muscles on those rope climbs, holding onto that rope, using the smaller lats.
Marcus Philly is the only man on his third and final run, and now Sean Sweeney is in second place. Marcus Philly with a huge lead here in the first of two heats. Philly making his third appearance at the CrossFit Games. His best finish was 25th in 2014. He's a former soccer player, played goalie at California Berkeley. Philly at the top of the first set of steps, and here comes Sean Sweeney, who told me before the competition started that he'd be the only guy out there wearing a cowboy hat, and I thought maybe he would take the field with it and then take the thing off, but he's worn it in every event.
I think a couple of people are really watching him because there are other people down there with cowboy hats as well.
Meanwhile, on the bottom left-hand portion of your screen is Con Porter. He was pushing for the lead in the first round, but now he has fallen way off the pace.
Now, one of the things I haven't seen, and I'm not sure if this is an issue with him or not, is just like Sam was talking about the heat down there on top of the snail, we have to remember the heat overall. I haven't seen anybody throwing water on their head, on their chest, anything as we're going around in these rounds. They have time, and the water's all set out there, so they can very easily do that.
Marcus Philly, though, is still your leader, is Porter, and that's the problem with the shorter rope. You have trouble locking your feet in there.
So he's expecting the weight of that long rope. That's what a lot of these athletes are going to be used to. And this is one of the things with CrossFit, and the test that we're trying to do is, can you adapt? Do you have the functional fitness to be able to adapt to anything that gets tossed at you?
Con Porter has fallen twice off that rope, but now just choosing to rest. And really, when you get into the situation, that's all you can do.
Right.
The overall leaders in the event are on the right, and Sean Sweeney trying to pass Marcus Philly. Here comes Logan Collins, and then James Newberry is behind him. Marcus Philly getting set to make the turn. So he will be the first man back to the rope, but he'll be followed closely by Sean Sweeney.
But watch how fast Marcus attacks the rope. He recovers himself on the way down, and just is so good at going immediately onto the rope. No rest at all.
Philly has had no problem figuring this thing out. Legless at first, and then he's found enough slack there at the bottom to get his leg secured. He's through one, and this will be his last one of the event, as he'll close out with a 40-foot snail push across the finish line.
And then something, once he gets off this rope, watch the way he works the snail. Very football style, short, choppy steps. He's not leaning over too far. And we had some debates earlier when we were watching the women at what would be the best push. He just keeps those feet short, choppy, moving, so he has the drive. Look at that, hips right underneath him. Not bending over too much. Quick, choppy steps.
Marcus Philly closer to the finish line. He's never won an event in his career at the CrossFit Games. His best finish was ninth in the sprint carry in 2014, and that's his only top 10 finish in his career. That might change with this performance here. And Marcus Philly has got to get across the finish line. Every second counts here as he is in. And Philly will win the heat with a time of 11:37.54. This is the battle for second place between Logan Collins, Sean Sweeney, James Newberry, and that's Zach Carchetti. James Newberry is in. Sean Sweeney getting set to finish up. He'll finish third. Newberry with a solid finish. 11:54.49 for him. Sweeney. And now Logan Collins. Final round for the majority of the field. Zach Carchetti's in lane number four. He's trying to work his snail across. Gary Helmick is in the green shorts as Carchetti's going to come across the finish line. Helmick is in. And Albert Dominique LaRouche coming across the finish line. This is Christian Lucero. And this is a different technique that we've seen, but it seems to be working for him.
Well, I know he's making it work, but here's the problem. You can see that it rolls back every single time. So, I get it. He's trying to save maybe the one leg or the calves or the glutes, but I just don't know. I wouldn't choose to do that. But at this point, just get it across the finish line.
Christian Lucero is in. Still the majority of the field, though, is in this event. Roy Gamboa will close out event number 8 for him, and now Lucas Parker just starting his final snail push. Parker slowly working that thing towards the finish line. And if you're wondering why the athletes aren't wearing cleats, it's because you got to run up and over that berm. They don't do you any good on concrete.
Yeah, but, you know, I did see his foot slip a little bit. I mean, would it have saved him a whole lot? Maybe. It's possible.
Meanwhile, Con Porter continues to struggle on the road climbs. He was in the lead to start. He's looking at his hands. Porter's got the gloves off. I don't know if he's going to make another attempt here.
So it looks like he's talking about his grip. And, you know, this could be just remnants of what happened yesterday. There's... I just think it was a remnants of yesterday's.
I can't hold the rope, man. It just keeps slipping out. It's bleeding through the gloves as well.
He's cut his hand.
That's he says. Great. I just can't, like, the rope just slides out of my hand.
Yeah, his ring finger on his left hand is bleeding.
But the fact that his hand, he's saying he's not able to hold on, his hand's cramping up. I just think it was from all the pulling yesterday. Plus, it's really, really hot. So if you are losing all the salts in your body, you're not able to cool down, and you have to deal with all that from yesterday. I've seen it happen before. Too many rope climbs, too much pulling.
The medical staff is now over to check out Con Porter's hand. We've had a couple more athletes finish. Zeke Grove just came in. Spencer Hendel came in as well. As 15 athletes have finished, Sam Danzer, Joseph Gessler, Jacob Anderson, and of course Con Porter, the only men left on the floor. And this is Sam Danzer, who is one of the bigger athletes in the field. And anytime you get a guy who's 200 plus pounds up there, I mean, that's a miserable experience for a man that size. I think Pat Sherwood, who's on the update show, said it the best. Sam Danzer is built like a baby hippopotamus.
But the sweetest baby hippopotamus you've ever met.
One of the nicest guys that you're ever going to run into. Won the deadlift ladder on Wednesday when he successfully lifted 20 increasingly heavier barbells that ended at 615 pounds.
Just massively strong. Yeah, this
he
is
may
not
as well
the
just
issue.
Pick this thing up and walk it across the finish line.
I think he probably could pick it up and carry it across the line.
Sam Danzer's got it moving pretty well. 21-minute time cap will not be a problem for him as he will make his way across the finish line. Con Porter continues to get treatment after he cut his finger on the rope climbs. Might try to give this another go. Adrian Bosman, the head judge, is over there to make sure everything is good. Danzer, meanwhile, will outrace Joseph Gessner 0.07 of a second. So a close race there for Sam Danzer as he will finish 16th in the heat. Joseph Gessner will finish 17th. Con Porter trying to get in every rep that he possibly can here. And if he can get through these rope climbs, he's got a chance. And the crowd coming to its feet after watching Porter receive medical attention and we get back on the rope. The problem is that he can't make a beeline. He's got to exit out of his lane. He tried to get right to that gate to take him up the stairs. He made a straight line, but he's got to go back through his lane. He's got to get up and over two more rope climbs and then a final snail push for him.
Well, on the plus side for him, at least he was able to sit down and rest to recover a little bit so he can have a nice, good sprint. It's going to be tough to see if he can get back in and get back up those ropes.
Con Porter coming in 29th place overall. And for a lot of these men who sit outside the top 15, maybe the top 10, right now it's them versus the test. And they want to get through the entire weekend and complete every event, however many there may be. Meanwhile, Jacob Anderson was having some trouble on the rope climbs. He'll complete that one. Anderson with one to go, and then he's got to push that snail.
And again, I think what these athletes have to remember, it's hot. If you're not going to win the event, if you are waiting to kind of try to eke your way through, sit down, put some water on you, cool off a bit so that you're able to go and attack.
Jacob Anderson and his brother Alex both in the field here. Now he's trying to wrap his feet, and this is the problem. He's used to having a rope that goes all the way to the floor. He doesn't have it here, and that can be a frustrating experience.
Well, he's getting frustrated.
About 2 minutes to go before we hit that 21-minute time cap. Con Porter's getting cheered as he is working his way back into the soccer stadium. If he can get up and down that rope pretty quickly here in the next 2 minutes, he may have a shot to get himself over the finish line inside that 20-minute time cap. He had plenty of rest in the middle of this thing, so he should be rather fresh.
He did have a good chunk of rest, and he only has two more rope climbs instead of the four.
Jacob Anderson, meanwhile, finds a way to secure his feet.
He just can't get his feet to bite down on that rope.
And Anderson is done. Less than 90 seconds to push that thing 40 feet. Sean Sweeney is running with him to encourage him. Con Porter's on the rope.
So Willie gets done, he's got some time.
And Jacob Anderson, as Sean Sweeney encourages him, has 40 feet to traverse to get himself over the finish line. Con Porter's on the left. He'll make the touch on his first of two, checking his hand. Jacob Anderson is in. Spencer Hendel and Sean Sweeney there to make sure that he got across. And now all eyes turn to Con Porter, who has one rope climb to go, 40 seconds to get himself across the finish line. So it doesn't look like it's going to happen, but this will be a huge victory for him if he can get to the top of this rope after suffering what looked to be a pretty sizable cut on his finger. And Porter,
and that's
a great effort.
Yeah, that's the issue with the short rope. You think you have enough, and then the second you want to go and get that bite with your feet, it just flips right out of your feet.
15 seconds to go, and Con Porter doesn't look like he's done yet. Give this kid some credit here. He keeps trying, just can't get to the top. And this crowd should give him a pretty good salute for his effort. As we hit the 21-minute time cap, Con Porter thanking the crowd for helping him out. It's Marcus Philly who wins the heat ahead of James Newbery, Sean Sweeney, Logan Collins, and then Zach Carchetti. Newbery and Philly, the only two to go sub 12. But this is where Con Porter started to run into trouble.
You know, for Con, it was all about the ropes. And we saw his hands. You can see his fingers are kind of mismatched there. His hands are cramping up. I think it had a lot to do with the past days with all the pulling. But man, what a way to go. Pop back up there, finish the rope climb and try to, you know, basically almost finish it. A lot of heart, and that's what's so great about the CrossFit Games and these athletes is they're athletes. They don't want to give up. They want to keep on grinding. Real impressive job. But, man, out of the gate, Marcus Philly, so good to see him back here. It was like this event was tailor-made for him. The rope climbs, he looked completely confident, completely calm. And, man, the second you got him on that snail, it wasn't a snail. Quick feet, very football, impressive.
And Marcus Philly is with Sam Farber.
Marcus, first time in competition, getting your hands on that snail and also the shorter rope. Fans want to know, what was it like with those two new event elements here at the CrossFit Games?
I think anytime you have new event elements, there is a bit of anxiety that comes about. You're not sure how it's going to go. And I think some of the talk in the back was that the new elements were going to add a level of difficulty that might give some maybe opportunity to like catch your breath or try and figure something out. But as soon as I got out here, the first two times through, there was no rest. I went through it pretty fast, and I realized that this was just going to come down to will and how much you wanted to push on that berm.
Marcus, you're a games veteran, but you took last year off, had a lot going on with your family, in your personal life. What does it mean to be back here in Carson and to take a Heat win?
Oh, it's a tremendous feeling to be back here. I am so grateful for the opportunity to be competing again on this stage. You know, you mentioned my family went through a lot last year, and my mom going through some difficulty with an illness and some treatment, my grandfather passing away the weekend of regionals. All of it was a lot to overcome. We did it as a family, and my whole family is up in the stands cheering for me, and I have my brothers in, and my nieces, and my wife, and just, they're just, it's getting to experience it with them is what it's all about, and I'm just so blessed to be here and to be able to come out here and do this. And on top of that, I said a little prayer to my grandfather right before we started that Heat. And I don't know, maybe grandpa was looking down and it gave me a little extra push.
The whole CrossFit family's here for you as well. Thank you, Marcus.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
An emotional Marcus Philly leaves the soccer stadium here, hoping he'll lock up his first career event win at the CrossFit Games. 20 more men to go, including Matt Fraser meets an old nemesis. We'll have it for you when we return.
My honest thoughts?
No. How are we supposed to look?
No other place have they focused on helping women to understand their full capacity.
It's helping redefine our cultural concept of beauty.
I feel beautiful in my body no matter what.
It's changed my life in a very positive way.
I've had my right hip replaced, left hip, left knee. After my last surgery, I came here and saw what was going on. I was scared. I lost 20 pounds. My range of motion has changed. Each day it's a challenge, but you have to think positive because I'm not ready to die yet, and I'm trying to keep hope alive.
Do you have to be fit to start CrossFit?
Oh, that's so not true.
I couldn't do one push-up. I couldn't run 400 meters.
I was out of shape. I was almost 300 pounds.
I heard of CrossFit, but I had no clue what it was.
CrossFit showed me a whole new level of what my body can do.
Nobody starts out CrossFit fit. You gotta start from somewhere.
It just takes one day to go inside and try it out. One time, and then you'll know that you can.
A new day and a new implement here at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. Thanks for joining us, everybody, on day four of competition. I'm Sean Woodland alongside Bill Grundler. Climbing Snail is the event, and it presents a brand new implement. That cylinder, we're calling it the Snail.
Look at those big, big cylinders. We got the rope, we got the short rope, the big cylinders. This is what CrossFit's all about. The CrossFit Games is all about is adaptation. These athletes haven't had a chance to play with this, and now they need to attack this. And how are they going to do this? Let's just take a look at that thing. It's a big, big, heavy object. And these guys are going to have to deal with 500 pounds of weight. How are they going to push it? They don't know. They're going to have to figure it out on the fly. They even haven't had a chance to see the other guys do it earlier. So it's going to be new and fresh for them.
20 men in this second of two heats. Your overall leader, Matt Fraser, is going to be right in the middle of the field. He will be in lane number 10, and the men chasing him won't be that far from him. Ben Smith, the man who won last year, will be right next to him. And then Alex Vigneault, another guy who could do very well in this event. But for Matt Fraser, this event is about exercising some demons.
He's in the exact same spot he was last year. Had a very nice lead, a very comfortable lead. Got into the weird movement work event, and he failed. And then it kind of messed with him a bit. He has a chance now to redeem himself. He has a nice lead, and here we go, some crazy things. But on the flip side of that, this is what Ben Smith was in the positive for him. It came to the weird movement, and he excelled here. He won the event that was similar to this last year and then started marching his way past Matt. So here's that back and forth between Matt and Ben. We're right at it right here, right now. This is the precipice.
Climbing Snail starts with a 500-meter run up and over the berm. Now, last year, you heard Bill say, Matt Fraser came in with a huge lead to start the day on Saturday. The event that he faced, it was called the Soccer Chipper, and it featured a heavy object, big rectangular object known as the pig that the athletes had to flip on this field. Fraser got so tired doing that he could not do the legless rope climbs, and that's what started his drop out of first place and Ben Smith's ascension to the top of the leaderboard.
Yeah, I just don't think he was ready for the failure that happened. I mean, in his own mind, he just the pig made it so he struggled on the rope climbs, and rope climbs are something that he's really good at. I think that really messed with him, which kind of continued that path for the rest of the weekend. Matt has been in a very different place this entire week. Winning events that you would normally say are going to be an event that he's going to win, and he's just been dominating so far. This is something he needs to do for him, not just point-wise and for, you know, to make his way to the podium, to the top of the podium, but for his own mindset, so he knows that he's telling the rest of the field, I'm going to crush you guys.
Right now, Matt Fraser has a 142-point lead over second-place Ben Smith. To put that in perspective, Matt Fraser could sit out this event, not do a single rep. Ben Smith could win it, and he'd still have a 42-point lead on Ben Smith.
That's what we call a comfortable lead. It's kind of a Rich Froning sort of thing, so we'll see if he can keep that.
Matt Fraser left on the run with a towel. That's on the bottom right of your screen, and then he dropped it on his path back to the rope. It's a smart move.
Well, we have to see what he's going to do with that. I would have thought if he was going to use it, that he put it at the mat. Let's have to see if he's going to pick that up.
He does scoop it up. Lucas Eschlinger is going to be the first man back to the rope. Alex Vigneault in the light blue shorts is to the left of Matt Fraser. Fraser in the white leader's jersey. He wore it last year at the soccer field when they did the soccer chipper. And now he starts his first legless rope climb. Has a little trouble locking his legs in, but Matt Fraser is going to be able to make it to the top. They have to keep their hands on the rope until they get below that black tape mark. Lucas Eschlinger is already done with two and on to the Snail. 500 pounds on the Snail. Lucas Eschlinger came in 25th place overall, so not really a threat to Matt Fraser right now. Fraser, the key for him is just making sure he finishes this event in a decent spot so he can maintain that gigantic lead that he has. And every man is on to the Snail now.
Don't see a whole lot of different strategies going on here with the guys. They're just trying to drive. They're trying to figure it out. The first round is about figuring this out.
Nicole Sager was done with the snail push first and then forgot he had to go back and make two more rope climbs. Nicole Sager's at the bottom of your screen. Next to him is Garrett Fisher with no shirt on. Next to Fisher is Lukas Högberg, another man who did well in regionals on the final rope climb event to get himself here to Carson, California. And Sager is going to be the first man done with round number one.
Now, if we're using last year's pig flip, rope climb, handstand walk as our comparison to this particular event, Cole Sager also did really well in this event last year. So I'm expecting to see him continue as he's doing. And with that football background, I think he's going to really be able to drive that sled, drive that snail further and not have an issue.
Just about everybody is back on the run. One man who's not notably, and now he is Matt Fraser. Matt Fraser has some catching up to do, but for him, if he just finishes middle of the pack here, he's going to be just fine. There is no way mathematically it is possible for him to surrender his lead here in this event. Now, he can't have that lead cut into by a significant margin,
right.
But he's not going to give it up.
And I don't necessarily think we'll see Matt do this, but I feel a lot of athletes in his particular position would not be competing in this event to win. And look, they are shoulder to shoulder, the two guys that are going just battling.
Matt Fraser cutting in front of Ben Smith as he hits the second flight of stairs up to the top of the berm here. And now Fraser trying to chase down Noah Olsen and Josh Bridges. And now that's Cole Sager, your leader. Behind him, Brent Fikowski, the rookie out of the Canada West region, who spent some time in the top three, but he fell down the leaderboard yesterday. He went from second and then wound up in eighth. He's won an event. He won the Ranch Mini Chipper on Wednesday. Scott Panchik and Ben Smith next to each other. Noah Olsen and then Lukas Eschlinger. Lukas Högberg with Bjørgen Carl Gudmundsen and Alex Vigneault. And now there's Garrett Fisher passing out of the screen. And here comes Rob Forte out of Australia. Matt Fraser, your overall leader, has made up some ground here on the berm. But remember, they have to go back to the lane in which they exited. You have to return in your own lane. And Brent Fikowski has passed Cole Sager.
And that's what I wanted to see Matt Fraser do. He's not playing it comfortable. He's going for it. He's competing right now to win. He's not competing to hang on. And I think that's huge confidence-wise for him.
Cole Sager will be the first man back to the rope. Patrick Vellner, the blonde in the multicolored shorts, is making his way back to the rope along with Fraser and Fikowski. Sager up first.
Wow, he
looks
good.
Done with one. Fraser's ditching the shirt and going to the chalk bucket. Sager making his second ascent. Gets his feet locked in. And Cole Sager, who played football at the University of Washington, so he's pushed his share of heavy objects onto grass field, is going to be really comfortable with the snail. Matt Fraser is done with one. Chalking up and going back up for his second one as Cole Sager is working on the snail. Fraser locks in the legs. And two will be down for Matt Fraser. Patrick Vellner, Josh Bridges, and Brent Fikowski all on the snail as well. But that man is your leader, Cole Sager, who has about 5 feet to go before he wraps up his second snail push, then back to the rig for two more rope climbs.
Sean, he attacked that snail when he first hit it. He hit it like a tackling dummy and really started some sort of momentum. And these things, you can't get momentum on them.
Cole Sager working his way back to Zeus. He'll close out round number two, and he has a pretty comfortable lead here in event number eight, climbing snail. The time to beat is in the upper left-hand portion of your screen. It belongs to Marcus Philly. Sager continues his steady pace as he could be done with both rope climbs before Matt Fraser even gets back to the rig. There are a couple of other men. Brent Fikowski is on his rope climbs, as is Patrick Vellner. Travis Mayer also towards the front of the pack as well. Sager's done. Round two is in the books. Matt Fraser has been watching prior heats because, as you mentioned before, you got to allow yourself more than you think you have at the bottom of that rope in order to secure your feet.
And I think he was a little slower. Well, he was definitely a little slower than I was expecting him to be in that first heat or that first round. I think he learned quickly, and he's just adapting.
Cole Sager was the first man back to the run. Brent Fikowski is in front, though. Now Patrick Fellner and Ben Smith is going back to the run. Josh Bridges, Matt Fraser, and Travis Mayer. Jorgen Gudmundsson also returning. Ben Smith coming in second place, 142 points behind Matt Fraser. He's got to get ahead of him here if he wants to start cutting into that lead.
And look at this. Look at the speed at which he's going. He's not letting these other guys. The other guys, they're recovering. He knows that that rope climb keeps getting hung up. And, man, he's attacking. I like to see that from Matt.
Matt Fraser is not a guy we thought would be towards the front on that 7K trail run over some pretty awful terrain there at the ranch in Aromas. Now passes Ben Smith. But Fraser really shocked a lot of people with his finish in that event.
And we saw Smith, he was walking, got passed by Matt, then Ben all of a sudden picked it up again. So we got a little head game going on here between these two athletes.
Ben Smith, the key for him, not necessarily winning this event, but he's got to get himself in front of Matt Fraser to start gaining points on the overall leader. Alex Anderson's in third, and Scott Panchik is in fourth, so the two of them also would like to find a way to beat the man in the red shorts, your overall leader, Matt Fraser. Now Smith has passed him on the run, as Brent Fikowski is coming down the steps first. He and Patrick Velder have both passed Cole Sager on the run, but we'll see how that shakes out when they get on the field and make the turn down their lanes. Matt Fraser threatening to reel in Cole Sager, and Ben Smith is staying with Matt Fraser, but falling off a bit. Brent Fikowski is going to be the first man back to the rope, followed closely by Patrick Velder. So a pair of Canadians leading here in the second heat. But Matt Fraser's going to try and pick up some points on the man that sits behind him, Ben Smith. Fikowski is through one. He's on the left of your screen. That's Cole Sager, who's had the lead going into round number three and now sits in third place. Second of two heats here in Climbing Snail, and it's Brent Fikowski, the rookie, out of Vancouver, out of British Columbia, Western Canada, making his first appearance here at the CrossFit Games, battling another Canadian, Patrick Velder, who's trying to catch up with Fikowski. Fikowski spent the day falling down the leaderboard on Friday, now trying to climb his way back up, and Brent Fikowski is going to lock up 100 points as he wins Climbing Snail. Cole Sager trying to catch up with Patrick Velder for second place. Velder's going to make it. Velder gets in. He'll get 94 points. Cole Sager can get 88. Now Ben Smith will get in ahead of Matt Fraser. Now the question is, what will the difference be between the two of them?
I honestly think that's a huge victory for Matt. No, he didn't win the event, but he didn't need to, and he was still up at the top, and that's a great position for him to be mentally.
Ben Smith finishes fourth in the event. Fraser will finish in fifth. So Ben Smith picks up 84 points. Fraser picks up 80. So only 4 points Ben Smith gains on Matt Fraser. The Fraser will now have a 138-point lead on Ben Smith, heading into whatever awaits them in the evening here at the StubHub Center in Carson, California. Jorgen Gudmundsson, Travis Mayer, and Josh Bridges have all finished as well. Scott Panchik is trying to get himself across. He's in the blue shorts. Panchik is in. Alex Anderson in the yellow, the man who came in third place overall, closing out his event. And Alex Vigneault is across. ...21-minute time cap will not be an issue for any of the athletes still on the floor. But Jacob Heppner just crossed, and now here is Noah Olsen. Noah Olsen coming in at 14th place overall. He's finished 8th overall the past 2 years here at the CrossFit Games. Rasmus Wiseman Anderson, he is in the light blue top. Rob Forte, no sure on, he's going to finish. And Lucas Eschlinger, one of the two men from Switzerland to be competing here at the CrossFit Games. The other, Adrian Moonweiler. Now, Rasmus Wiseman Anderson, who has won the team competition before with CrossFit Invictus, did that in 2014, making his first appearance here as an individual. And Travis Williams is the only man left on the field. Two rope climbs and then a final 40-foot snail push, and a little less than 7.5 minutes in which to do it. Mentioned it before, but Travis Williams started CrossFit in 2011. At the time, he weighed 268 pounds. He has totally transformed himself, and here he is competing at the CrossFit Games for the second time in his career. Williams with one more rope climb.
There he goes.
Now it's on to one final 40-foot snail push. And this entire crowd here at the soccer stadium is going to be behind Travis Williams.
Trying to chill those hands out. Those ropes are hot, and you saw the way they were trying to come down quickly, so a lot of them were getting some rope burns on their hands. Yes, they did a lot of pulling yesterday, so the hands are going to be a little bit tender, but they want to cool off those forearms, cool off the grip, cool off those hands, chill them out and get them ready, because they know they're not done yet.
And remember, that snail has been sitting out in the sun here too. Everybody who's been handling the snails on the event staff here has been wearing gloves. Brett Fikowski is your event winner. The top five in this heat, the top five in the event. Patrick Velder will finish second as two Canadians lead the way here in the final heat. Cole Sager will finish in third. Ben Smith picks up 4 points on Matt Fraser, but Matt Fraser still your overall leader.
Man, Cole Sager came out like a madman for those first two rounds. Really set the tempo for the rest of the field. Looked unbelievable on the rope climb, but that's the same thing that got him here to the game, but he excelled in the rope climb event just out of the regionals to get to the games. This was a great event for him. So much power on that snail, able to drive, just, I mean, football background all the way.
Cole Sager finishes third in the event. Second place, Patrick Velder, who stayed with Sager and Brent Fikowski through this entire event.
He hung in there with the mix and went back and forth. You can see him passing Cole Sager. And I think that's a really good mental position, especially for a rookie to come in here and just kind of have that and then finish so strong.
Finally, Brent Fikowski, who had a rough day yesterday, started the day in second place, fell to eighth, but he's going to work his way back up the leaderboard after this.
And then the professor did what he does best, which is pacing correctly. Let the field go out. By the second round, he started making his move, and man, he was so fast on the rope climbs. I really think his length aided in that. The drive, he looked super calm, and I know he's got a great engine and just a great way to finish.
Brent Fikowski is with Sam Farber.
Brent, physically, that was a grind. As soon as you were done, and some of the other athletes too, hands went right in the water. What caused you guys to do that? What was the hardest part of that challenge?
I'd say the toughest part of the event was climbing that hill every time. And then when it was done, we're all pretty hot. It's a hot day, so the quicker you can cool down, the quicker you can get ready for the next one.
It's your second event win here at the CrossFit Games. First time was up at Aromas, not quite the same crowd. What's it like to do it here in Carson?
They're both pretty satisfying, but with the crowd here, it was a little sweeter for sure.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Brent Fikowski locking up his second event win here of the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. Matt Fraser will hang on to the overall leader's jersey. For all the leaderboards and athlete interviews and updates, head to games.crossfit.com. Matt Fraser, your overall leader, has made up some ground here on the berm, but remember, they have to go back.
It was a huge event for Fikowski, obviously. Let's take a look at where we're standing right now. I think we can take a look at that right here. We're going to get that for you guys in a second. But yes, Fikowski, Vellner, I mean, this was a huge event for some of our key athletes.
Yeah, it's funny. It's almost like these Canadian athletes are tied together. You can see on the event eight results, Vellner right behind Fikowski. Well, they were seventh and eighth on the leaderboard, so they've been sticking together throughout this entirety of the competition. This actually should put both of them up or around the top five after this event, picking up some points on Scott Panchik, on Alex Anderson, some of those other athletes that were ahead of them. So it does have some pretty big implications on the overall standings.
What was unexpected here in this event?
Well, I thought Bjørg and Carl Gudmundsson would do a little bit better in this. It dropped him a little bit. I'm kind of surprised at that. Panchik outside of the top 10, it drops him down. You see Alex Anderson, Fikowski, Vellner kind of hanging tough in spots 3 through 5. Fraser, another strong finishes as well, staying inside the top 5. I mean, at this point, he has one finish of 23rd in the deadlift ladder. He has a 6th, a 5th, then all 1sts or 2nds. I was talking about earlier, this is an opportunity for redemption for him, and you know what? He really showed up big. He made quick work of the rope. The odd object wasn't tough for him, and another great performance.
Awesome. Let's take a look at women's standings and see where we're at right now with the women athletes.
Sam Briggs. I mean, what an amazing story. We keep talking about it. You know what? She wasn't supposed to be here. This event played to her strengths. She won that. It put her up into the overall lead. But you know what? If there's some people you don't want chasing you down, it's the likes of Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Catherine David's daughter, T. Claire Toomey, and Cara Webb. Look at that top 5. All the top 5 international. We have the top U.S. athletes in Christy Aremo and Tennille Reed right in front of Brooke Wells. Maybe not necessarily the leaderboard you'd expect from some of the American athletes. And then Annie Thor's daughter down in nine. Definitely an international flair in this top 10. And Sandra Pacelli holding strong in the top 10. A nice bounce back year for her so far overall.
Who do you think is really going to surprise us coming up next?
Well, it's tough to say. We know some events for tomorrow. We have some of the handstand walk, the sprint. We have the plow. The plow is kind of an X factor. You're not really sure. But you know some of the gymnasts like Katrin David's daughter. I know Tasia Persevich is really stoked for that event. And then maybe some sprinters. I'm excited to see what some of the runners like Sam Briggs can do in this event, because it's not a quick sprint. It's a little bit longer. And having the handstand walk before that really kind of tests your endurance a little bit, so you're not necessarily going to see the fast sprinters always win this workout. So I think some people like Sam Briggs and Katrin, some usual names, if you will.
How do you guys feel like they held down the snail? Because that was the curveball object. No one even knew what it was. The athletes had never even touched it before. And I can see some of the athletes checking out the earlier heat, just seeing like how to even maneuver this foreign object.
Yeah, it was kind of interesting. You can see some of the athletes that maybe played some other sports that know some of the same principles that carry over. You know, keep your feet moving, fast hands, just keep the tension on the snail going. Even talking to Katie Monner-Henniger before in one of our earlier shows, she's like, you know what, you can't get away with giving those big heaves and expecting it to gain momentum, because that sand's going to fall right back down to the bottom of the snail. It's going to stop it dead in its tracks, and it might even roll back a little bit for you. So the ones that we saw, the people that we saw that were most successful, kept their hands, fast feet, and they were able to capitalize where other people couldn't quite adapt as fast.
Well, we do know that Dave Castro is getting ready to make the big announcement to give us an update on the afternoon schedule.
I'm kind of curious to see what he's got in store for us. It's, we kind of followed the mold last night of some stuff that we might have saw last year. But you know what? That rig out there looks pretty impressive.
He looks ready to announce Dave Castro, ladies and gentlemen.
All right, athletes, bring it around. Hustle up. Just don't come forward of this area. Stay right there and just get long. We have two events tonight, two events that I'm really excited about. They're both going to be really fun. The first one we call the separator. The first one, go ahead and bring out the barbell. For the men, is going to start with 12 ring handstand push-ups to those high rings. Paul, come forward. Go ahead and demonstrate the standard. Straight legs, press, the legs can slide up the rope, just like that, the straps, good. And come down. You cannot use your legs to pull up these straps to assist in the movement. So it's essentially a strict ring handstand push-up, but first you need to muscle up into it. Then you're gonna come down here, and you're going to do 15 back squats at 225. Good. You'll do the 15, drop it. And then you will do 20 burpee over the bar. Of course, all of this will be moving down the floor, right? Right. Then from there, that's one round. You'll go back and you'll do 9 ring handstand push-ups. You don't have to do 9, but you can just go back there to simulate that you're gonna do it. You'll come forward to the bar. You'll strip some weight. Strip 10 pounds, yep. And this time, the reps will increase, the weight will decrease, and you'll do 18 front squats at 205. Good. You'll put the barbell down, roll it forward to a certain zone, at which point you'll do 20 bar-facing burpees. Then you're done with the second round, you'll head back and do 6 ring handstand push-ups. Good, come forward, strip the weight off, strip 10 pounds off each side for a total of 185. And how many reps do you think are gonna happen here? 20. 20 overhead squats at 185. 21. When you finish with your 21, you'll put the bar down and you'll do 20 burpees over the bar. And when you finish that, you'll head across the finish line for time. You have descending reps on the ring work, fixed reps on the burpee, ascending reps on the barbell work with decreasing load. Any questions on that? That's the male version. The female version is a little different. Let's get a female demo team member to come out here. Anyone? Three, two, one, go. You're gonna run forward to your barbell. First movement you're going to do is 15 back squats at 165. You don't have to use that bar. Then you're gonna do 20 burpee over the bar. Then you're gonna go back to that height ring and you're going to do 6 ring handstand push-ups with the same standard as the men have, but you don't have to muscle up into it. You can go from that height. You'll then come forward to the bar again. You'll strip off weight and you'll do 18 front squats at 145. Put the bar down. And how many bar facing burpees? 20. Good. You'll go back to the rings. This time you'll do 4. Come back over. Then you'll do 21 overhead squats at 125. Put the bar down. And how many bar facing burpees? 20. And then you'll head back. Finish with 2 ring handstand push-ups and then run across the floor and cross the finish line. This movement is very challenging. And what's gonna happen, we do not expect that all of you will be able to do it. What's gonna happen is the first 2 movements, the 15 back squats and the 20 burpees, that's gonna be the tiebreaker for all the females who can't do 1 ring handstand push-up. So if you go through that first part, when you run back to the rings, that's your time if for the next 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you try to get a ring handstand push-up and you can't. So listen to this. For all the females who get 1 ring handstand push-up or more by our standard, you are graded on the 100-point scale. So let's say it's 30 women. 30 women are able to do 1 ring handstand push-up or more. 1 through 30 are graded on the 100-point scale. If you're a female athlete who cannot do 1, then the 31st place athlete, you are not graded on the 100-point scale. You are graded on the 50-point scale to even further penalize you, essentially. Does that make sense? If not, we'll clear it up more in the briefing area. But it's pretty straightforward. If you don't get a ring handstand push-up, you're going to be heavily penalized. Yes. It's not a big deal. You'll find out. Yeah. Can you do a muscle-up straight into the handstand push-up? I don't know. Can you? Yes. Isn't that what he did? Do you want to see it?
Yeah, sure, yes.
Yes, you can do that. You start at the hang. You jump up on the rings, grab the rings. Worry about that in the brief. Athlete brief. Adrian will give that to you. Okay, that's the first event. The second event, the second and final event for this evening. Are you guys having fun? I think that's the problem. You guys are having so much fun. I think I want to make you wait. We were going to tell you that second event here, but we're going to make you sweat it out a little. So you guys are going to go through this event, and then later this evening, right before that event, I'm going to brief the other event to you guys. So you do not get to know what the final event for this evening is until 20 minutes before you do it, if that. Question. All right, head back to get the brief from Boz.
Wow, well, we knew ring handstand push-ups were coming. We didn't know when. Now we know that's the very next workout. Everyone, I'm joined by two special guests, the 2010 champ, Graham Holmberg, and 2015 fourth fittest man on earth, Dan Bailey. Guys, thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Well, we got quite the announcement from Dave Castro. Obviously, starting off with ring handstand push-ups is a massive departure from what we've seen in the last few years. But the totality of the workout, there's a ton to chew on here. One of the biggest announcements is if athletes aren't able to complete one ring handstand push-up, then they're going to be graded on the 50-point scale versus the 100-point scale. What are your initial thoughts on that kind of point separation?
I think it's good. I mean, it definitely adds a new mix, and as an athlete who's trying to value, okay, there's more events to go, how do I attack this, and do I try to conserve energy? Now it throws a wrench at you where your points are going to be really hindered by not getting work done.
So we have a slightly different variation of the workout for the women. We've taken a look at the workout here. 15 back squats at 165, 20 burpees, 6 ring handstand push-ups. Then the squats go up, 18 switch to front squats. The weight goes down to 145, followed by more burpees, this descending ring handstand push-ups, 4 in total. Then the reps go up for the overhead squats to 21. Weight drops once again, switches to overhead squats. Then you got 20 burpees as always and 2 ring handstand push-ups. Tell me about a little, at least for the women, what's the kind of cumulative effect of this workout over the course, even getting to those final 2 ring handstand push-ups?
Yeah, based on what we saw with the demo, we saw that it looked like the handstand push-ups were the first, but now that I see it the way it's listed out, you're going to be quite fatigued the first time you touch the ring, so that's going to make a big, big impact for some people, especially on that final round coming off overhead squats and burpees. It's going to be challenging.
And Dan, this is kind of like a Sunday brunch workout, as my colleague Pat Sherwood might say. There's a little bit of something for everyone to trip on. Tell me about maybe the overhead squats, or what else could people trip up on this workout despite having the ring handstand push-ups?
Well, I have a little bit of insight into this one. I did it more than once leading up to the games here, testing something like this. It's a little bit different now that it's back onto the floor and been announced, but everything is still there in its potency. It's going to be a really tough workout, and coming off of all the pressing into holding the weight, overhead squats, all that, it's going to be really difficult, especially having done Murph, the cumulative volume. I can't wait to watch him do this one.
So we have a slight different variation for the men. They will start with ring handstand push-ups. There's 12 of those, 15 back squats at 225, 20 burpees, then 9 ring handstand push-ups, 18 front squats at 205, 20 burpees, 6 ring handstand push-ups, 21 overhead squats at 185, and 20 burpees. So this is the first time we've actually seen ring handstand push-ups at the games since 2010. Graham, that happened to be the year you won, and you also won this workout. But this form of a movement, what are some points of performance that we might not see just from the outside looking in?
Yeah, I mean, you know, first looking at it, you're going to have athletes wrapping their legs around the straps, and that can be a factor where in 2010 you could get away with a little bit of almost what they call bench pressing the movement, or even climbing your legs up the straps. And it's going to be interesting to see how the standard plays out, because if that's how you potentially practice it, and that may not go today. So it could definitely throw some people off their game if they're getting no rep, because it's a lot of energy used. and you're getting no work done.
Dan, you tested this workout like you just mentioned, and we have varying ring heights for the men and the women. Obviously, that plays a big factor, but how big of a factor is it having to muscle up into the first ring handstand push-up?
I've seen a couple people, I checked out Instagram after that movement was finally released to see who's practicing, what are they doing. You know, you see people doing it off the floor, and you're like, oh, that's a bad call, you know, because in your head. But some people I've seen try to flip up, and they're just not capable of doing it. Getting over that fear of kind of losing sight of where you're at and flipping up and getting your legs on the straps, trusting it's going to be there. I don't think the muscle-up itself is going to be that big of a deal. The transition with all the fatigue of the workout, with what's built up over the weekend, may catch some people off guard, but really it's just going to be that ring handstand push-up. It's going to catch a lot of people.
It's going to be fun to see it play out. Guys, thank you so much for joining for me today. An awesome pleasure having you guys by the set.
Thanks for having us.
Guys, stick around. We'll be back in just a moment with a little bit more breakdown and a look forward to event number 9.
I like the idea of someone serving and then working in an environment that's certainly more positive, less risky, and yet the pattern of service and commitment and giving continues.
Some of our military training is very similar to CrossFit training.
Get up there, Remy. Get up there, Remy. Nice.
It's a little extra spice for the day. It's going to be lovely.
For me, it's kind of a natural transition.
Yep, nice, Remy.
Take the skills and experiences that I've learned in the military. And positively affect others.
You know, you can do that, did you?
Maybe a little bit slower, give you a little more tension. As a coach, as a mentor, as a trainer, I try to change people's mindsets on how they think about themselves and try to make people better.
Welcome back, everyone. So now we know why that is called the Separator. This is definitely going to be one of the most challenging events and one of the most interesting to watch.
Yeah, I mean, obviously the ring handstand pushups as a movement is a separator, but there's also a separator in points.
Right.
Obviously, if you don't meet the work requirement of hitting one ring handstand pushup, and with that 50-point grade scale, if you are one of the few outside looking in, that could make a huge dent on the leaderboard.
Well, with these requirements, who are we looking at with the women?
Well, for me, one athlete in particular stands out, and that's Kari Pierce. She was a gymnast at the University of Michigan. Now, the women gymnasts don't utilize the rings that much, but the principles that play into being good in something like this, shoulder stability, overhead pressing strength, quality body control, situational awareness with your body, these are the things that will make someone successful in this, and Kari Pierce has that from the gymnastics building blocks that she carries. She showcased some ability to adapt to gymnastics with the pegboard last year, and I think she'll do well in the ring handstand
yes,
pushups.
The gymnasts will definitely excel on this one. What about the men?
Another gymnast, I think Patrick Bellner, he just came off a strong second place finish in this last event in the climbing snail. I had a chance to catch up with Patrick during his athlete interviews, and I asked him if there was anything he was looking forward to, even with the injury, the injured bicep that he had. He said, I'm looking forward to the ring handstand pushup because I was a gymnast. I'm used to the handstand pushups on the rings. I've done plenty of ring work, and I think this is a movement where I have an advantage over some of the athletes who may not be comfortable turning upside down on the rings. I should be fine with those. So I think he's going to do just fine.
What type of toll does a movement like this take on the athletes? It's quite taxing.
Well, I've done these once before, and it is absolutely taxing on the shoulders. Look at how people burn out with regular handstand push-ups. It's one of those movements where you can come out way too hot, and the minute they're gone, they're not coming back. And then now you add a unstable element in terms of the rings, the inability to kind of stabilize for the most part. You have kind of a frictionless environment there. That's only going to amplify it up
yes.
to the nth degree. So I think we're going to see some athletes that maybe look great on round one, maybe even on round two, and get to round three, you know, where you have some overhead squats looming as well, and their shoulders are just kaput.
This is going to be an intense crescendoing effect. And speaking of taxing movements and needing some sort of rehabilitation, Arosti is here, guys, in the Vendor Village. And if you go check them out, they're actually offering free treatments and free consultations. I'm definitely going there next. Take a look. Let's learn more about Arosti.
There are plenty of things that go into being an elite athlete. The way you eat, the way you train, and the way you recover. Lucky for the athletes, the team at Arosti have got them covered. Dr. Bassett, at Aerosta, you guys obviously play a big part in keeping the athletes healthy. What's something that you look for in the athletes, and what's the most important thing for you guys when treating the athletes?
Well, the most important thing for us is to keep the athletes going through the entire weekend. I mean, they put themselves through incredible stress, physical stress, and they have some incredible things they have to do while out on the field. So our job is to keep them healthy, keep them moving. We look for a lot of mobility issues that will lead to further injury down the road. If we can keep them active and mobile, then we know we can prevent these serious injuries from occurring and allow them to do the incredible things they do out on the field.
What treatment are you giving Ben at the moment?
So right now we're working through his lumbar paraspinals and his QL.
Ben, how does the treatment feel?
It hurts, but it helps. Yeah, I'm not going to lie, it hurts.
So the treatment definitely makes a big difference to you in competition?
Definitely, yeah. Just being able to recover and stay loose during the weekend is huge, so that definitely helps going with 14, 15 events or however many we're going to do this weekend. It's pretty rough.
I am making my appointment immediately.
Yeah, if you hear the fittest man on earth, Ben Smith, say it hurts, you know it definitely hurts, but it's a good pain, you know?
It's a good pain. Feels so good, right? Don't forget it, guys, the Fit Expo stage in the Vendor Village. Make sure you make your way out to Barbells for Boobs. Basically, they're incentivizing fundraising so more women can get breast exams. It's so important. Make sure you go and support this amazing cause. They also are encouraging people to share their stories. It's really important. It's an important part of the CrossFit community, so make sure you stop by. We also have an update of the Saturday competition schedule. Let's see what we got coming up. Obviously, we have Women's Event 9, the Separator coming up, and then the men, and then we have another announcement.
Yeah, Dave Castro said that he's going to announce something else after the men take on the Separator at 6:05 tonight. At this point, I don't even know what there's left to tackle. We're so far into the competition, but still so much left.
So mysterious, so exciting. Guys, do not forget to keep sending in your photos. We love, love, love hearing from you and seeing all of your amazing pictures using the hashtags CrossFit, CrossFit Games, CFG10 for the 10th year anniversary, and, of course, CFG Hunt for that awesome scavenger hunt that's going on right now in the Vendor Village. Here we are. Here are some of our favorite picks.
What an awesome shirt.
Love that shirt. There, yes.
Stars and bars. That is awesome.
It's the whole red, white, and blue ensemble. Here's Toomey.
Oh,
she's adorable. I love that picture.
At the top of the leaderboard, still taking time to Instagram. Looking great, Miss Toomey.
Love it.
A little action shot.
Yeah. So awesome.
Hashtag that's Paleo Nick. He's out there in Vendor Village, one of the guys supplying food to the rest of the group. Awesome photo.
Paleo Nick, I hear he has some really good ice cream sandwiches, just saying.
Might have to get some of those.
I would like one. Hint, hint. Not like being subtle at all. All right, guys, so keep sending in those pictures. Let's check in with the weather. Feels like 88 degrees. I would say it's kind of fair. It's sort of cooled off a bit. I don't know. It's pretty hot, though, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a little humid, but it feels like it's cooled off a bit, despite what it says on the weather forecast.
That's because the wind has picked up to a gusty 9 miles per hour.
I mean, we have these weights on our desk for a reason, to keep the wind from blowing our papers away.
It's true. Guys, we're going to see you in just a bit. Coming up next, we have Women's Event 9, The Separator. We'll see you in a bit.
Right hip replaced, right knee. I had a laminectomy, left shoulder replacement twice, left hip, left knee. I'm a diabetic, I have a cardiac problem, and I have arthritis. I was in rehab in July, and it gave me a lot of thought of myself and what was going around in my age bracket. I had some real serious thinking and re-evaluating my whole life. After my last surgery, I came here and saw what was going on. I was scared, but I took the challenge. I lost 20 pounds. My range of motion has changed. I have not been able to tie my shoes since 2006. I can tie my shoes now. Each day it's a challenge, but you have to think positive because I'm not ready to die yet, and I'm trying to keep hope alive.